gang rape is funny.
Hi, I'm June Allison. Notice you haven't seen me in movies for a long time. That's because I always wet my pants. Remember my love scene with Jimmy Stewart and that Monty Stratton picture? I was soaked. Do you know Gene Kelly's famous dance in Singing in the Rain? That wasn't rain, that was me. But I'm back, thanks to Deep End Adult Diapers. They're so absorbent, it's like having two rolls of toilet paper in your back pocket. Oh, and each diaper has colorful pictures of the great stars of the 40s. Fred Astaire, Donald O'Connor, and there's me. June Allison. I still wet my pants, but thanks to Deep End, I'm working again.
Oh, she's off the deep end now because June Allison, well...
She died?
That's it.
That's what I heard.
Yeah. That's the rumor going around, that she's very dead. Anyway, before I even get to June Allison dying, guess what movie I was watching last night? I already told you. Josh, I don't know how you actually watched the whole movie, and I apologize for sending it to you.
What's that?
Rear Window.
Oh, now you don't like it?
Well, in its time, it was okay. It was like a, you know, one of those real slow 50s movies.
That's what I...
It was very, very slow, and there wasn't much going on, and it was very corny dialogue, and just, I have no idea how you stayed all the way through that. You know, the fact that you watched that all the way through, and you fell asleep in the middle of the network, that tells me that you've got some real problems.
I think it might have been Grace Kelly or the ballet dancer that got me through it.
Oh, the ballet dancer?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's inspiring.
What about Miss Lonely Heart?
She'll do the
and whatever happened with those pills? Did she actually take the pills or not? I guess not. Maybe the dog took the pills.
Yeah, we never did find out.
Yeah.
We need closure, Alfred.
Do you notice when they put the dead dog in the basket? They put the dead dog in the basket.
Huh.
And they pulled it up, and the woman there was screaming and hollering, "Oh, why are you? Did you hate him because he liked you?" And she's screaming and carrying on, bitching out her neighbors because somebody killed her dog. And what they pull out of the basket is like a limp, like a rag doll.
Right, like a stuffed
animal. You almost see the Four Seasons singing rag doll.
Yeah.
Huh?
I wonder if the dog's name was Precious.
Do we really have the crow on for 3 hours tonight?
Absolutely.
Holy moly.
Yes,
of course,
yes.
I guess that's figuring that the sports nerds will be watching the All-Star game. I heard the Humper say he's going to be watching it. Well, I'm glad he will because I sure as hell won't. How many pitches will you be watching in the All-Star game? I vote for none. George, we already know, goes without saying none.
The what?
What about Josh?
I'll dabble. I'll watch a little bit of it.
No, we're not asking whether you're going to dabble or not. We're asking whether you watch the All-Star. We know you're going to dabble.
I'm not going to watch the whole thing.
Oh, my God. Just like that World Cup final. If there was any doubt, and of course, the Italians here, there's 500,000 Italians in Toronto, and they were all having a field day going crazy and, just going nuts. Thank God they don't live anywhere near me. But what is that all about? All this hysterical nationalism, you know. Oh, that makes us, what does that make you, okay? Especially with the big match-fixing scandal they had over there in Italy in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Doesn't it kind of like cast a dark pall on that whole thing? All the diving going on, and then the guy from France that was retiring, and I have no idea what his name was, and I could care less. He headbutts the guy and gets tossed out of the game.
I saw that. What a hole.
Garbage. What an a-hole, is that what you said?
What a French hole. Yes.
God. Oh, speaking of holes. There he is. The Fumfier in chief. June Allison, the sunny, raspy voiced, perfect wife of Jimmy Stewart, Van Johnson, and other movie heroes, has died, her daughter said Monday. She was 88. Oh, that's old enough. Allison died Saturday at her home in Ojai. I never heard of that. I never saw it in print. It's some place near L.A. in California, I guess. O-J-A-I. Maybe it's O.J.
Maybe it's Ojai.
With her husband of nearly 30 years,
about 30, man.
David Asher at her side. She died of pulmonary respiratory failure and acute bronchitis after a long illness. During WW2, American GIs pinned up photos of Rita Hayworth and Betty Grable, but June Allison was the girl they wanted to come home to. Petite, blonde, and alive with fresh-faced optimism, she seemed the ideal sweetheart and wife, supporting and unthreatening, in other words, sexless. I had the most wonderful last meeting with June at her house. We were such dear friends. I'll miss her, said lifelong friend and fellow actress Esther Williams. Remember Esther Williams? Wasn't she the bathing suit model?
Yes, she was.
Who could be a day over 100 now.
That's right.
With typical wonderment, Allison expressed surprise in a 1986 interview that she had ever become a movie star. I have big teeth. I lisp. My eyes disappear when I smile. My voice is funny. I don't sing like Judy Garland. I don't dance like Sid Charisse. But women identify with me. And while men desire Sid Charisse, they'd like to take me home to meet Mom.
And she
was married to actor-director Dick Powell, and then that went down the toilet. And then she, after Powell's cancer death in 63, she battled breakdowns, alcoholism, and a disastrous second marriage, and bada-beep, bada-boop, bada-bop. After graduating from a wheelchair to crutches to braces, Ella was inspired by Ginger Rogers dancing with Fred Astaire. That was her real name, Eleanor Geisman.
Okay.
She was six when her alcoholic father left. And it goes on with all kinds of information about somebody that almost nobody in our audience except Chicken Neck and I know who the hell that is. And you know because she peed a lot.
That's right.
Or at least she invented those.
Well,
she
all of those, them, but those commercials. I mean, we all grew up with those.
Yeah, everybody grew up watching June Allison plug in Depends. If you pee in your pants, it depends on where you're doing it. So get a lot of Depends. Or just buy some duct tape. Always comes in real handy. We were just talking about that before the show. Like in that movie Hollow Man, it's
That's a good thing
there was a bunch of roll of duct tape in that room where they got locked into.
That'll solve all your problems.
Because her boyfriend is lying there with his guts ripped wide open, and all she does is take a nice piece of duct tape, and not only does it stop the bleeding and heal him up real nice, but then in the last scene of the movie, he comes and saves her ass.
That's right.
Isn't that great? Oh, India Train Blasters, Una Bomba Grande.
Right now it's
many bombas.
Here in... In India, so...
In Mumbai, which used to be Bombay. That'll teach them to keep changing the names of them places, you know?
Well, it's the British that changed it in the first place, so...
At least 15 killed in blast rock commuter trains near India's financial capital. Does anybody care about that?
No.
No, that's because you don't have no India people in South Florida. We got Indians all over the place here. Some of them are very nice people, and some of them smell very bad. It's that curry thing. Here's a fax before we get into your poll result from yesterday. We will do 1,000 votes, I believe, today, which would be quite an accomplishment in the middle of summer. 546 right now in today's poll. Think we'll do it?
Oh, you can do it.
Oh, we're going to push heavy duty for that. Because look at the rest of that schedule. We got Kimball Camper. It's the 11th of July, man, and I do not lie. When I tell you that on the 11th of July, here we are at WQAM, and we still are no closer. We haven't made, we've done nothing. We're still doing the revolving dough from 2 to 4. And, boy, are we paying a wicked price for it or what? Well, they're negotiating with Kenny Walker and his contract, and Mad Dog agreed to do 2 to 5. And a Humper, they're going to, like, try to, like, beat him over the head with a broom handle to try to get him to go back to the afternoons where he belongs. There's just nothing happening. We're, like, in suspended animation, like Larry King. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
Just amazes me. But the checks keep showing up a day or two early, which is fine. That's all I care about. But we apologize for the ineptitude and the petrified forest, you know?
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like a tree that's been petrified.
Or like a bug frozen in amber? That kind
yeah,
of
that might be it. They're in suspended, they just can't make a move. They're, should we do this? They just ain't doing nothing. And, of course, what's his name? Your buddy, the GM, he's still got that lobotomy thing going. And then Duff came in this morning to tell me about whatever he's got, some... What has he got?
Don't ask me. I wasn't listening.
You got something, huh?
I was totally not listening.
No. You didn't hear what I said to him?
You fairy!
Yeah.
By the way, Mark from Hallandale Beach says, this is kind of cute. Oh, and I bet you Josh never saw Fatso, did you?
No, I never saw that one.
So George gave me a spy report. He said you saw the whole Imaginary Heroes and you loved it?
I thought it was very good, yeah.
It is very good. It's a great movie. You see what I mean about Sigourney Weaver, how good she is in that?
It was great.
She
see, the part you mentioned, the part where she walks in the head shop is great, but when she's getting arrested, to me, is the funniest part, when she's talking to the kid.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And Josh isn't gay, but you might be.
It figures. Makes sense. That's a great line. It makes sense. So speaking of great lines, Mark in Hallandale Beach says, just wanted to let you know that Fatso was finally released on DVD. Well, that means I can send you guys Fatso.
All right.
I've heard seen it, but you, Josh hasn't.
That's a keeper, I think.
Now, you'd like that.
Josh has a very good sense of humor. He likes wry comedy, non-standard comedy. I think he'd like
it. You see, because a lot of the stuff that we play, like...
Get the honey, Junior.
It doesn't mean anything unless you see the movie. You're like poor Anne Bancroft, who's dead. Like,
you ain't the only!
Means nothing unless you've seen the movie. And then, of course, that whole feeding frenzy...
Right.
I like Lakshin
Kogel. Me too.
Me too. Oh, yeah.
And Mark's
point
see that. In the facts is also very funny. I've forgotten all about that.
He says Fatso was finally released on DVD a couple of weeks. Oh, guess what else was released on DVD? Ed Wood.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I heard. I heard he would.
I don't think Josh would like that because, first of all, I don't think he's probably that much into Bela Lugosi, number one. And number two.
Well, he should. He should watch it.
Number two, one, like I told you, once you've seen the first 15 minutes, it just keeps repeating the same thing. Eddie, please come, Eddie, you know.
Eddie.
Right?
This is Eddie.
Yeah, that we should have sent him over to see Bela. But anyway, Fatso, you're like. It says, unfortunately, the disc has no added features. Well, I don't know, but I don't usually watch the added features anyway. Call me crazy, but I don't watch the added features. Oh, and George watched Why We Fight.
Yeah, Riveting.
He's been talking about it, and everybody out there should be forced to watch that, but you won't. Mark says, I've got to say my favorite line in the movie is when Dom says to his brother Junior during breakfast, you know something, Junior? You don't know how to run your plate. Your omelet should come out even with the bread. You don't know how to run your plate. Yeah.
That was great.
That was great. Although I did like where he said, you like bread. You love bread. I like bread.
Right.
Remember he kept giving him too much bread?
Right. I love bread.
No, he says, you love bread, I like bread. Junior says to Dom.
Mm-hmm. But I do.
Start giving me lines from Fatso.
That was my line, I love bread.
It reminds me of the caller you had several years ago when he asked how you worked the plate at the buffet at the Emerald Coast. Do you remember that idiot?
How do you attack
the buffet at the Emerald Coast? Oh, thanks, Mark. Glad he brought up Fatso because that's a movie that everybody should see during the dog days. There's so many boring hours for you to fill. It's 180 degrees in the shade. People are in a coma, which I can easily understand. And especially with his sports crap on, man, that World Cup. Whew, man, there's nothing going on. I watched it in HD, the entire thing, from beginning to end, if you can believe that. That's probably the first time I ever watched a soccer match in its entirety in my life. And the last time, too, by the way. Well, I got, got all caught up in the hype. I felt like I was obliged to watch it, like I might miss something. I wouldn't have missed nothing. It is. Oh, and then you know who's a real jackass, which I already knew this? Jeff Greenfield, that mealy-mouthed commentator on CNN who never says anything, who's supposed to be there. I don't know what his title is. He's a jackass. He's a real hole. And he goes through a commentary about, well, the rest of the world is into soccer so much, and maybe the U.S. can finally... No. Can blame the U.S. for a lot of things, including our crappy foreign policy and our idiot president, but I'm going to tell you right now, soccer sucks. It is. Nothing happens. And then the guy will here's a chance, and he kicks the ball like 40 yards high and wide of the goal, which the goal is about 80 feet wide anyway. It is stupid. And then to decide the championship on penalty kicks, that'd be like deciding the Stanley Cup on shootouts. See, they have shootouts in the NHL during the regular season.
Yeah, but it takes playoffs, 8 years to score in soccer.
And in the playoffs, they don't have it as shootouts because the games are too important, so they have overtime until somebody scores. Well, if they kept playing the game until somebody scored another goal, they'd still be playing that game, I think. So they have to have shootouts. And a guy is like, it would be like, you know what it's like? It's like if you were playing like dodgeball and a guy stands 5 feet in front of you and he's got like a bowling ball and he's got a golf ball and he heaves it right at your head and you're like, you're going to get out of the way? Well, that's the chance that the goalie's got to stop at those penalty kicks. They're not going to stop him. The one that France missed, it hit the crossbar, and it came down and missed by 2 inches going over the goal line. And that decides the championship. Plus, that trophy is such a little piece of crap, you know. Even people who hate hockey know the Stanley Cup is a big, beautiful, it's got some substance to it. Got some size. But that little pukey trophy for the World Cup, although I think it's appropriate. Just amazing how many people, and then I'm reading Barry Jackass writes about, the ratings were this, and Univision, and all them Argentinians and Brazilians. By the way, how did Argentina and Brazil do there in the final? Were they in there?
No.
I didn't see them for a change, thank God. That's the big thing in Brazil, is that half the men are, half the women are men, and the other half would like to be. I don't know how that works.
Well, the men are men, and so are half the
women. 1013 at 560 WQM. For years now, I've been telling you about a great place to drag all your friends. Take them to the pot. The Melting Pot and their fondue restaurants. Boy, what a fantastic treat this is. If you haven't been there in a while to the pot, now's the time to go back. It's a full 4-course dining experience starting with their renowned cheese fondue, and they serve it up with 3 different breads to dip and dunk in there, Granny Smith apples and crisp veggies. Next comes your choice of lively salads, and then your entrees include a combination of all kinds of really nifty stuff like lobster, filet mignon, shrimp, Cajun seasoned chicken, pork, duck, portobello shrooms, and lots more cooked in oil or broth. I got quite a story about mushrooms later on, by the way.
Really? Imagine.
And don't forget the Melty Pot's homemade dipping sauces. They really make your fondue experience a blast. And here's the clincher. When you're done shoving all this good stuff in your puss, top it off with their famous chocolate fondue desserts with fresh strawberries, bananas, pineapple, cheesecake, brownies, and tasty marshmallows rolled in crushed Oreos or graham crackers for dipping only at the Melting Pot. And like I tell you all the time, and it's the truth, it isn't just another meal at another restaurant. It's an experience. You'll find a pot in Fort Lauderdale, Kendall, Boca, Cooper City, North Miami Beach, and Coral Springs. Tell them that Neil sent you and the gang by for a real fabulous eating experience at the pot.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QAM.
I got your Crowbotics right here, homeboy.
This is the Crow, and we're talking hardball on 560 WQAM. Call me, homie, right here at 567-H-O-O. Oh, 56, call me, homie. Let's be talking to Steve in Miami. Steve, you're with me, Warren Kamati,
Well, Crow, what do the Marlins have to do to win the World Series this year?
Oh, that's an easy one, Steve. They got to swing the bat, hit the ball, pitch some strikes. Remember, the game of baseball is 50% hitting. That's almost half. 50% fielding, 50% pitching, and 25% managing.
But, Crow, that's 175%.
What? Don't you be questioning me. Would you be ignorant?
Be what?
Ignorant. Ignorant, I said. You be ignorant.
Well, no, I'm not ignorant.
Boy, I play professional baseball in a third world country against men half my size. Did you?
Well, actually, I...
Not even that.
I played in...
Not even that.
Are you going
to...
Can I...
Call me, homie. I'm the Crow. Out of gate G. Elemental B.
1018 at 560 WQM. We got Kimba Bocamper at 2, Mad Dog at 4, and then we got the Crow talking hardballs from 4, from 7 to 10 tonight, followed by the Andy K Show. I guess we got the Crow on there because the All-Star Game is on, and we figure anybody that's a baseball fan would be watching the All-Star Game and wouldn't be listening to us anyway. So rather than signing off and doing transmitter maintenance, which we couldn't get any spots in there, we just throw his ass on, right?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, right. Another bad piece of news, just hot off the wires. They're dying like flies, man. Oh, you're going to be very depressed when you hear this, although you're not going to know who it is. Mylon B. Williams.
Who?
See what I'm saying? But once I tell you who he was and what group he was with, and then what song, oh, man, if you had this, he wrote their first hit. If you had this song in your vast collection here, I'd be very pleased, but I don't think you would do.
Well, sounds like a challenge.
It is. Mylon B. Williams, one of the original members of the Commodores. Died after a long battle with cancer. He was 58. He died Sunday at the University of Texas MD. Why is it that, you know, June Allison died on Saturday, and now we get the news today. It's Tuesday, last time I checked. And this guy died Sunday, and it just takes a long time for this to come down the bonsai pipeline, I guess. At the University of Texas MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston, said Joanne Geffen, a spokeswoman for the band. I wonder if she's kind of like David Geffen. She sure wasn't his wife. Williams, who played keyboards, was one of the founding members of the Commodores, which formed in 68, while all three members were in college at the Tuskegee Institute in Alabama. I never knew that, did you?
No.
The group, whose best-known member was, of course, the unctuous Lionel Richie, had a series of hits during the 70s and 80s, including Brick House, Easy, and Three Times a Lady. Oh. But...
Yeah.
I don't want to hear that.
How about Easy?
No. Oh. So depressing.
Music
Commit Suicide by Williams wrote the band's first hit, Machine Gun Man. That's the song I was titled.
Oh,
Machine
yeah.
Gun.
No, I know the song, and I don't
know. One of the great instrumentals of all time.
I'm fun to go get it.
It's good Machine Gun Man. He was once, twice, three times a brother, and we love him. He gave all that he could give to the Commodores. He'll always be remembered, said band member Walter Orange. Huh. Walter Orange, who's probably dark. Although, you know something, there are a lot of those, there are many of the groups, which is the one thing I love about those Time Life infomercials, is where they have clips of the different bands that you never saw them before, and you had some of them that you thought were black are actually white and vice versa.
Right.
And some of them that you never thought, you never saw before, actually like Bo Donaldson and the Haywoods. He was a pretty good looking guy, Bo Donaldson.
The most common thing is realizing how ugly a lot of these people were.
Most of them, yeah. He is survived by his wife, two sons from previous marriages. The funeral will be on Friday in Okolona, Mississippi, where he was born. There'll be a memorial service in L.A. in August. Mylon B. Williams. The name would mean nothing, but if I told you he was one of the founding, one of the original Commodores, you'd say, oh, my goodness.
Oh, my God.
Right. Especially Machine Gun. You don't got it, do you?
No, but I'm getting it.
I had it on a red 45. You know, in the radio business, how we went back in the days when we played music? We used to get all those radio station copies. You know, there were all these neat colors, green and red, and you know, like translucent. You know what I mean?
I do.
You ever see those?
Some of those, oh, slick, some of the clear see-through.
Oh, yeah, some of those really neat-looking 45s. Well, anyway, I had Machine Gun on a red disc, on a red vinyl disc. Oh, man, that was something. I wish I still had that. I don't know what I'd do with it. Where the hell would you play it?
I still have a turntable.
One of every kid's best possessions in the 50s and 60s was the automatic 45 RPM. Not the one that had the different variable speeds with 33 and even 78, but just the 45, the little small one with the spindle.
Right.
Right?
Absolutely.
With the changer on there and you just load up all your 45s on there?
That's right.
They're dying like flies. First, June Allison, and now this schmuck. Here's George's poll from yesterday, 997 votes. Oh, we can top that during the show today. What was that poll? I'm not even going to go into it because I'm afraid to ask. the one before, the one that you took on a Friday for over the weekend? Because I voted I hate this poll, and I see everybody else did, too.
Yeah, ESPN did that poll. Josh saw it and suggested it. I thought it was a good idea, and everybody voted
They certainly didn't have all those words on there that you put on there, some of which I'm certainly positive you weren't saying on the air.
No, I was not.
Oh.
I was saying popping.
Oh, okay. Oh, like finger popping.
Right. Fine.
Exactly. Look at that, Hank Ballard and the Midnighters. It's finger popping time, right, popping it like a zit. What do you miss the most, George asked yesterday? 997 votes. There it is. There's Machine Gun Man. Well, let's play a little bit of this. In honor of, what's his name, who died.
This is great. This is from the Boogie Nights soundtrack, as if there aren't enough reasons to like that movie.
Funky. Not too many instrumentals really crank my chain, you know, but this is one of them. I just love it.
It's funky. That's it. That's all I got. That's all that's downloaded so far.
Oh, really?
I mean, that's all I've got.
And where's my new disc, by the way?
What do you want?
My iPod is getting really lonely. Oh, did I mention? I know I did, but I got to say it again. This BlackBerry, what's the number, 8700, the new one?
I forget.
This thing is slicker than witch's butt, man. It is just the best. If you got one of them old first-generation BlackBerries, just throw it in the toilet and get you a new one, the 8700. I mean, it is phenomenal. I just mentioned that in passing. What do you miss the most? $9.97. Low gas prices, $3.47. And by the way, boy, you must have been psychic because the lead story here in the world, gas price hits an average $2.97 a gallon, the second highest level ever in history. Thank you, Mr. President, for those low bargain basement prices of gas.
The economy
You're
is great.
Gas.
The economy is great. Don't worry about the deficit. Stop talking
the
about it.
The average price consumers paid for gasoline jumped almost 4 cents over last week to $2.97 a gallon, the second highest level ever. The national pump price for regular unleaded gasoline is up 65 cents from a year ago, and not far from the record 307 reached last September after Katrina disrupted petroleum supplies. The rise at the pump reflects an increase in U.S. crude oil prices, right, which accounts for about half the cost of making gasoline. They always have some excuse, and then a couple of months later they'll say, oh, Exxon and all the other oil companies reporting record profits. Stop and think about that, okay? If they're gouging the hell out of the public and they're making record profits, then well, what's the excuse? How can there be an excuse? That's why that movie that I sent you, which you ought to be kissing me on the kneecaps for that.
Well,
why
I'll,
we fight.
I'll blow you a kiss. How's that?
That's the definitive movie about the world and why we're in the shape that it's
that's
in today.
It. We're just tools. We don't have a chance.
That's right. We're in the war business.
Eisenhower
warned
us.
The big war machine, man. We got to keep greasing that war machine,
mm-hmm.
Whether it's Vietnam, whether it's Iraq. And they're all based on a bunch of lies, by the way. And like I told you last time I was on, didn't we do a great job in Korea? That sure accomplished a lot.
We don't have any more problems over there.
Right. The price for U.S. oil delivery in August hit a record $75.78 a barrel last week at the New York Mercantile Exchange. And all you people at the gambling channel, by the way, CNBC, I still say you ought to be on death row. You ought to be in prison. Kenny Lay had the decency to have a heart attack and die. When are you guys going to do it? When's that Maria Bartiromo going to turn in her bags for a box, bitch? And your buddy David Ted David, whatever he is with two first names? Never
yes.
Trust a guy with two first names. As soon as, you know who is the best example, if you look that saying up on Wikipedia, you know who this picture is there?
Doi.
Howard David, two first names. Never trust anybody with two first names. Rick James?
Yeah,
right?
Dead.
So it goes to show you. Oh, Moe is dead? The pump price has a long way to fall before meeting the EIA's current forecast that gasoline will average $2.76 this summer. Yeah, right. What do you miss the most? Low gas prices, $347. Democracy, $2.61. Oh, I remember that. The land of the free and yada yada. Teen sex, 190. Freedom of speech, 93. That was my vote.
That was my vote.
That, like it was almost yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Good radio, 73, which of course went hand in hand, I think, with freedom of speech. Also with less of this, corporate crap.
Yeah.
Where a few money-grabbing companies bought up every damn station in America. And the FCC said, oh, go ahead and have a good time. Have a good time. Just chop them all up, baby. When in doubt, chop them up. And acid, 33. So who do you like better, Timothy Leary or Dennis Leary?
Oh, Timothy, definitely.
That'd be a good poll question to take someday.
Timothy was more fun at a party.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, but he never sang that.
I don't know what kind
Let's
of bag
play that again. Let's play that today all day.
Do it.
4 hours.
Double dog dare you.
Oh, man, it's going to be a lot of fun today. I just have that feeling in my bones. Might not take too many phone calls today. In fact, might not take any. Because George gave me a spy report on the crap that's been coming in, and why would that surprise me, huh?
I don't know. He's right there on line six.
Dog days of summertime with anybody with a half a brain gets out of that toilet?
This is Neil Rogers.
Absolutely.
This is 560 QAM.
They don't come any better than Neil Rogers.
His sentence was ahead. There goes his heart. He wanted to go quit, but then we thought, don't question the conspiracy. And fraud is gone, and now we wonder.
Like I said, at least he had the decency to croak. Okay, here's our poll today, and it's one of my usually fine efforts, I would say. I'm trying to think of what inspired me to do this poll.
I don't know. All those political documentaries.
Oh, there was a story I saw on the news last night about Jew Lieberman, and I just came rushing in here. And I,
bye-bye.
He gives me spilkies, man.
Yeah,
don't be so sure of that. Now he's filed a run as an independent.
Still.
So by hook or by crook, even if he loses the Democratic primary in August, he's still going to wind up being on the ballot.
Just wait. Who's going to vote for him?
632 votes, other than your president. You notice how I put your president? I had Eric underline it because he's not my president. I don't want nothing to do with him. Other than your president, the politician you hate the most is Dick Cheney. Was there ever any doubt? 279. He's got almost half the votes, 44.1%. One of the great crooks in the history of the U.S., one of the biggest liars, crooks, devious bastards who belongs, no question, in a federal penitentiary right now. Dick Cheney, 279, awaiting news conference on deadly Boston tunnel collapse. When the hell was that? I didn't see that.
It's a developing story.
Is it?
That's what they're telling me.
No,
right
get out of here. There was the Boston tunnel collapsed? How the hell could I miss a story like that? Mm-hmm. I've driven through that baby a zillion times long ago. Catherine Harris, 62. They hate that bitch. By the way, I have a story about her later on. It says even the Republicans don't want any part of that bitch.
I know.
By the way, did you hear about her plane? Oh, man. I heard that the rain in Spain falls mainly on her plane. Jeb Bush, 58. Swillery, 48. Let's see, 46. Tom DeLay, 44. Jew Lieberman's got, look how many he's got.
About 30, man.
Including my vote. There was never any doubt in my mind. He, like I said, he makes me want to scream. Rick Santorum, speaking of screamers, 25. That's all he cares about is fetuses and faggots, Rick Santorum. That's all he knows from, fetuses and fags. That's a medley of his agenda. Oh, there's that Hamid Karzai in Afghanistan with the Rumsfeld. What a good pair they are. Mm-hmm. A couple of stooges. All we need over there now is...
Doi, 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 doi.
Mo. I hate this poll, 22. Ted Kennedy, 22. George Herbert Walker Bush, that was Bush 1 or Bush 41 or Bush whatever. 11. That's the partner of the Saudis, business partner. Newt Gingrich, 9, and the only reason he's only got 9 is because out of sight, out of mind. They forget how obnoxious he was, the contract on our freedoms. Rudy Giuliani, 9. John McCain, 8. Total phony. If you see him in this movie, Why We Fight, you'll understand what a total sellout he is, an absolute phony and full of crap. Saying all the right things in that movie, and then all of a sudden the phone rings. Oh, the vice president's on the line. I can't finish the interview here. I've got to go talk, get more instructions from Dick. John McCain, 8. Bill Clinton, 4. Al Gore, 3. And John Kerry, only 1. You know, it's interesting about John Kerry. They don't hate him. They just don't want any part of him.
Right.
Remember all the polls that we've taken about who would they like to see run? And,
sure.
Lukewarm about him.
He's not a bad guy. He's just weak.
Do you know what he's got in common with Hillary?
Waffle, waffle, waffle.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah. A couple of wafflers, man. She really is starting to piss me off big time.
Starting? Thanks for catching up.
No, but I mean increasingly, like day by day.
Waffle, waffle, waffle.
Another great waffler. Well, bada beep, bada boop, bada bop, and she's just, she is... Strictly nepotism, that's all about it. If her last name was Smith, there wouldn't be anybody give two looks at that bitch.
That's right.
But because it's Bubba's wife, see? And actually, what it really is that the public wants Bubba back again for a couple of more terms. But if we can't have him, we'll have the next closest thing. Let's just vote for Monica, what do you say? Especially after, now, did you ever go out and get the inquiry that I told you to get?
Yeah,
you did.
Oh, yeah. Shocked and dismayed.
Now, if she wasn't a walking cow, a walking, talking, fetching cow... If she didn't weigh at least 600 pounds, then I'm talking through my ass. Wow, what a gigantic monstrous she is. Now she's probably eating her frustrations, you know. She went through a lot of issues. 641, diplomatic moves ongoing. More developing stories there on CNN. And they're showing them, they're just making dollar bills. They were cutting up a bunch of bills. If there were hundreds, I'd have taken more of an interest. More good news from Iraq, by the way. Nothing but good stuff going on over there. Am I right?
Oh, we're fine.
Every day.
Gunmen in Baghdad intercepted a minivan carrying a coffin to the Shiite holy city of Najaf today, killing all 10 people on board. Another 5 people were killed in a double bombing at a restaurant near the Green Zone. The van was attacked in the volatile southern neighborhood of Dura by gunmen in 2 cars. Mahmoud and Captain Firas Ketai, who's Mahmoud? Oh, Lieutenant Thayer Mahmoud. And Captain Firas Ketai said those killed were Shiites taking a coffin to be buried in Najaf, 100 miles south of Baghdad, a common practice among Shiites. They were just schlepping a coffin down there. A lot of dead bodies, a lot of coffins. A parked car bomb followed by a suicide attack around foot struck a restaurant frequented by the police. The restaurant was about 200 yards from the entrance to the Green Zone, the fortified area that houses the U.S. and the British embassies and Iraqi government offices. Let's get that bad news out of the way real early. Throw it on the ground. There you go. I just heaved it on the floor. We don't want no bad news, no mo. It's hot, it's steamy, it's sticky, it's nasty. People don't want to be, like, inundated by this important stuff. They want important things like America's Got Talent. Isn't that what's important?
What else is?
And, of course, these good calls, too. WQAM.
I'm my friend.
Uh-huh. Sure. I was already hanging up before I even, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
The finger was back on the button. WQAM, hello.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Hey, yeah, I want Neil to listen to this. I got the song that he was asking about, that the Commodore song.
The one that we just played on the air 10 minutes ago?
Oh, you did? Oh,
yeah,
no,
get out of here. Get out of here, loser. that you know something right there? Those two. Prozac Ron, who needs to be, by the way, taken out. I'm not talking about taken out for dinner. I'm just talking about taken out.
Oh, we could take him out for dinner. Just
bring
him back.
Take him out. Yeah, take him to Louis in the Bronx.
Take him for a boat ride.
And then, of course, this nitwit who you just got through playing that. George went through all kinds of herniatic gymnastic stunts.
That was no trouble at all.
To get that for us and to play that on there. And then this guy, I got the song Neil was talking about, that machine gun, yeah. And you know something, sir? Turn it on yourself. That's what I would do. Do a Kenny Lay. Do the world a favor. Croak like a frog, as they say in Montreal. One of the most distressing and disturbing stories, this thing about if ever there's a case not just for capital punishment but for vigilante justice, this one is from Fresno. And this isn't about those cookie-baking anti-war 80-year-old protesters out there in Fresno either. Remember them in Fahrenheit?
Yeah, they were dangerous.
Cookie-baking grandmas.
What was in those cookies?
The rape of an 11-year-old girl may have involved as many as 10 men, most of whom are football players at local community colleges. There's that jock mentality again, baby. Why are people surprised that this crap goes on?
I'm not.
The jock mentality, man. We got to be macho and beat the crap out of women and rape them and abuse them. That's the whole mentality. Remember all the time, we're talking about the fact that most jocks, even if they're not, they claim to vote Republican all the time?
Mm-hmm.
It's a macho thing.
That's right.
That's what it's all about. You got to be with the macho party. Not those wimpy commie pinko fag Democrats, but you got to be with a macho like, you know, Charlton Heston and Ronnie Reagan, the real macho guys. Reagan used to be macho before he croaked, but then again, he forgot about those days. Police arrested 2 men in connection with the rape Saturday night, and officials said they identified 8 others as persons of interest. Most or all are students at either Fresno City College or Reedley College. Wonder if Greg Reed's got something to do with that. The victim, a runaway from a group home, went to a Fresno apartment complex Saturday night to visit an acquaintance, said police spokesman Jeff Cardinal. While she was inside one of the units, she allegedly was sexually assaulted multiple times by several men. The girl then fled the apartment and sought help from a couple on the street who called the police. The victim was taken to University Medical Center for an exam. Mackie Davis, 20, and Eddie Scott, 19, were arrested on 1 count each of child molestation with the victim under 14 and oral copulation with the victim under 18, both being held at Fresno County Jail on $100,000 bail. The rape allegedly took place in housing arranged by the Fresno City College football team. Davis and Scott were students at Reedley and may have been in the process of transferring to Fresno City. Calls and emails to Fresno City Athletic Department not immediately returned. Calls to Reedley also went unanswered. Can't imagine why, can you?
No.
That's the jock mentality, baby. Let's get those women and rape them and just beat them up and make them black and blue and, you know, abuse them, because that makes us a hell of a lot more macho.
This is Neil Rogers.
Especially this dangerous 11-year-old girl.
This is 560 QAM. Rock solid.
at my junior, honey.
I can't close the leads.
Well, the leads are assigned randomly.
Yeah, what about the new leads, huh?
Yeah.
The new leads.
I can't close. Nobody can close them.
They're old.
The leads are garbage.
Nobody can close.
The leads are weak.
All I need is a lead.
Closing isn't always easy, especially if you're only given the old leads. What if with one phone call, you can get fresh new leads and actually close enough to get yourself on the Cadillac board?
Get the chalk! Hey, get the chalk! Put me on the Cadillac board!
It's not too good to be true. It's the Glengarry Leads, the leading provider of good leads on pink cards with gold ribbon wrapped around them, not the ones on the blue cards you're used to trying to close on.
You hear me, you faggots?
No matter what kind of property you're trying to close on, Glengarry has the leads you need.
These are the new leads, and you don't get them.
Unless you call now, 1-800...
Glengarry Leads. They're for closers.
That's 1-800...
Get to work!
That's 1-800...
Have you made your decision for Christ?
Call Glengarry Leads now, and you'll receive...
$6,000 and one Cadillac.
That's 1-800...
Close!
Oh, and also...
I don't care how many Dago, Guinea, Wop, Greaseball, Goombas come out of the woodwork.
14 to 11 at 560 WQAM. Here's a fact from Andy in Miami Beach, who says all the Dago, Guinea, Wop, Greaseball, Goombas came out of the woodwork on Sunday in South Beach. It's that stupid-ass World Cup soccer match, man. The one where basically almost nobody scored after it was 1-1, real early. Lincoln Road and Ocean Drive was packed with thousands of Italians. Actually, there aren't too many Italians in South Florida, just a lot of Guidos. And there's a big difference. Although, to be honest with you, that soccer team, they were real Italian Guidos. Honking, screaming, and parading around with huge Italian flags. When are they going to realize that they're in America now? If I walked around Rome like that with an American flag, I probably would be beaten. And rightfully so, by the way. Oh, yeah, they were going crazy at Il Colosseo, I see. 600,000 crazy Italians out there by the Colosseum. Do you see that?
No.
Also, says Andy, now here's the part we've got to do a little homework. We've got to look this up. Wikipedia. What is it, Wikipedia.com?
Yeah, I'm looking at it now since you mentioned
it. Oh.
I got an email from the guy a while back, but I forgot to look at it.
Who did?
I got an email from the guy saying, hey, I just wrote a Wikipedia article for Neil, but I forgot to check
it out. Also, I noticed that your Wikipedia entry has been finally filed. I had nothing to do with it. Know that you will not be happy with it. It is easy to change, and if you don't know how to do it, I can do it. So thank you, Andy, in Miami Beach. What does it say? You got it?
Yeah, I'm looking at it. So far, so good.
This is another one of those puff pieces, one of those things that, because everything on the Internet about me is always negatory. Oh, WINZ, the city of Hollywood wants to get Neil Rogers off the air, and Hallandale wants him off even worse. And, yeah, stuff like that. That's it. That's the legacy that I leave behind. Everybody else who was ever on, probably even the Crow has got a better, well, of course, because he was a big jock, you know? He used to take showers with guys naked. Celebrity atheist list, I made that.
It seems fine.
Is it?
The write-up. Very informative. I don't see
any. Yeah, here you go. Hollywood City Commission chastises WINZ's Neil Rogers, 1987. Well, screw you, Hollywood City Commission, and Mara Galante, too, okay? Because life is a beach, you bitch.
Want me to fax this to you, or are you just going to look at it?
Yeah, go ahead. It'll save me the effort. I don't feel like... Although, the good news for Josh is that my, thing? My Alexa... My Alexa toolbar has got itself straightened out today, so I can very quickly email him 50,000 stories for tomorrow.
Oh, well, thank God.
Aren't you relieved now?
I am.
Hey, listen, all those neat movies I'm sending you, let me write it down. I got to get Fatso for you today.
By the way,
I don't have to, huh?
Not only did Tito write an adequate article about you, but at the very bottom there's a link to the neilrogers.com website.
Well, good. We got 340 some odd friends there on our MySpace thing.
I'm
pretty impressed by that. Our goal is 1,000. If we can ever get to 1,000 friends.
There are some chicks on there with like 6,000, 9,000.
Oh, by the way, speaking of chicks, thanks for the one who sent me the Tom Brady's ass picture there. I mean, yeah, he does have his uniform on. That was kind of cute. She has a thing for Tom Brady's ass, I guess.
And I heard you had a thing for Tom Brady.
No, I don't. I don't have a thing for anybody's ass. Trust me when I tell you. Why did you just know? What you did is you just sent me the fact. You faxed me.
Sorry, wrong page. There's pages everywhere down here.
Oh, so Andy and Miami Beach faxes. Oh,
yeah,
sorry,
read it again. Did that.
That's a good way to kill some time.
Coming at you now. I grabbed the wrong cheat.
Okay. WQAM, hello. QAM. Wouldn't this be a shame if I finally decided to take a call or two? WQAM, hello. Hello.
I'm listening.
Yeah, good. Uh-huh.
Do, 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 do.
Very weak. Oh, that must have been Curly. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Mr. Rogers.
Yes.
I have a thought. Why would any other country want to get rid of us
who are they going to sell their bull crap to? Nobody buys more crap in this country. You know what I'm saying? So without this country, where are they going to sell their crap?
China. What is he talking about? Oh, here you go. Neil Rogers, the Wikipedia, the free encyclopedia, redirected from Neil Rogers. What does that mean? I don't understand what that means.
Whatever.
Radio personality, KT. No, it wasn't February 76. It was March 1.
Okay.
That's okay. Worked at several stations, including WIOD. Airs weekdays 10 to 2 and WQAM. His on-air personality, a shtick that may be best described as caustically comic, has earned him high ratings throughout his career, until recently, of course, when the whole station's in the toilet, and he's considered somewhat of a local icon. Oh, I'd rather be an iconoclast.
Yeah, I couldn't see that.
Couldn't you?
Yeah.
What'd you think about it? A typical Rogers show consists of commentary by Rogers mixed with listener callers, interspersed with pre-recorded comedy bits. He's been described as a shock jock, although he's not so in the classic sense of radio personality such as Howard Stern. Well, thank God for that. Who the hell wants $500 million a year or whatever he's getting anyhow? God. How can he have an ego when you're making that kind of money? It just astonishes me.
I don't know.
The kind of money that he's making, I would check the ego and the hair and the nose at the door, wouldn't you?
Sure. That's just baggage.
For just like 10% of it. Several successful radio personalities could be proteges of Rogers, including Bob Lasseter and Randy Rhodes. Well.
Howard!
Blabo is I keep reading his blog entries every day on, what is it? Lasseter, what
Blog
is it?
Lasseter.
BlogLasseter.com, yeah. And lately, like the one yesterday about how he's, after all this business about his kidneys are failing and there might be a kidney stone, he doesn't know. I'm hoping for you, Bobo. Hang in there, Blabo. Currently, Rogers lives in Toronto. No, I don't live in Toronto. I just hang out here most of the time. We broadcast this show remotely. Remotely.
Kind of cute.
Oh, yeah. When you're on WQM, everybody broadcasts remotely.
That's a good
that
line.
That's the best I ever saw. Who did that again?
Tito Alvarez,
Tito.
Here, local fan.
Thanks, Tito. I wonder if he and MJ are busy.
We'll fix that one, March 1.
A monument to me over in Bahrain.
We'll fix that one.
Maybe they can get me on the payroll over there in Bahrain. Okay, everybody else is taking graft. How come I can't get it? I need it to keep feeding those machines, man. I'm done with those machines. Boy, they're killing me. 681 votes on our poll today. 681. You think we're going to make that 1,000?
Oh, yeah.
If we can get up to 800 by what? By noon, I think we got it licked.
All right.
We can do 100 an hour.
Start licking.
682. Now, who was it that said that? Was that Tom Hopkins said that? No, that was...
Suds.
Now, so I heard a spy report that Suds has been on with you. Who the hell told me?
Yes, he
that?
Has. I don't know.
Huh?
One of your...
Somebody said...
Start licking.
Oh. Yeah, one of my spies told me that he had Suds on Friday, and I thought, well, what's new about that?
Nothing.
Is he on every Friday now, or what?
Like every other Friday, whenever he can make it.
Whenever he can make it, whenever he can get some good food
That's
in
right.
to feed him. Maybe Johnny Dark would come and visit you.
I'm sorry,
if
what?
You're real lucky. Oh, I got to play that jingle. What?
Which one?
Johnny Dark said it.
Yeah, that one.
Whole.
Oh. Well, you didn't even say the first part.
No, he didn't.
He said the whole, he didn't say the whole word. I got an article here that you are going to be squeezing your kneecaps. You're going to be so excited because I know that at least one of these people you hate like poison.
Well, let me roll my pants up.
Oh, God. Yeah, roll your pants. In fact, where's June Allison when you need her? You could probably go through a case of Depends. You're going to be just peeing all over yourself when you hear this.
That depends.
Ted Rall, somebody
oh,
you
I
already
love Ted
like
Rall.
To begin with.
I just posted one of his cartoons today, as a matter of fact.
He writes, Gates and Buffett, 1,000 times worse than Ken Lay. How do you like that?
Okay.
I don't have time to do it right now. I'll do it after the top of the news. Although I do have time to rip Dan Abrams an ass. First of all, he's an ass to begin with. Anybody that watches MSNBC, all five of us? He's a real egotistical jerk who, you know, he's a lawyer and his father was a famous journalist, so he thinks he's hot stuff. And he's a jerk. And his show was a real loser there on MSNBC. So, like they usually do, it's kind of like Howard Premer at KAT, only on a much grander level. Hey, Dan, how'd you like to be the general manager of MSNBC? Oh, yeah. Let me say it again for the umpteenth time. The only thing that they have on that network is Keith Olbermann. That's the only thing as they continue. Now, did you watch Outfoxed yet?
No.
Well, why not? I sent you that nice package of all those documentaries on there, and how come you haven't watched Outfoxed yet?
I've been a busy man.
Well, watch it.
Tonight.
I mean, if Josh could even watch Imaginary Heroes. Now, that one scene there, I mean, there was something, I guess the kiss was probably a little bit disturbing, but you could kind of feel that coming anyway, so to speak.
Yeah, I could. I told George it was just funny that my roommate happened to be walking in when that scene came on.
Right.
And,
no,
perfect timing. He's like, yeah, Neil recommended this one to me. He's like, yeah,
uh-huh.
I can tell.
He said, yeah, figures. Oh, very nice. Now, your roommate.
Right.
Is this the Russian chick or is this a guy roommate?
No, I got a guy as a roommate.
You got a guy and the Russian chick?
No, I don't live with the Russian chick.
Well, why not?
Come on, man.
That's smart.
Need some space, buddy.
You live with a guy?
Yeah.
With all the big bucks that you're making?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. You got to be kidding me. Well, that kind of must interfere when the Russian chick, I guess you must go over to her, who she live with?
She lives with the parents.
She lives with her parents. You're living with some guy. Well, like I said, I knew it was too good to, I knew it was too good to be true.
Don't sleep in the same bed.
Yeah, it ain't, whatever the hell that show is.
Supernatural?
Supernatural. That ain't going on, you know. We got rooms.
Yeah.
I got news for you. If Sam was your roommate, I'd be over there before midnight.
Pushing the beds together?
Yeah. Pushing something.
You maybe, but I'm not.
So what are you trying to say now? You got a male roommate and you both sleep in there. You don't have double beds. You got a, what is this? You sleep in the same bed, did you say?
No.
In a hammock.
Isn't that what he just said?
Sorry.
They both sleep
690 votes on the poll. Oh, God, we're still kind of verge of greatness here today. If we can make 1,000 today, I might come back for a while on Thursday.
This is Neil Rogers.
Thank you.
This is 560 QAM.
This is the Neil Rogers Show. This is your brain. Any questions?
Now, Inside Edition.
Tom Cruise.
Look, you never know what I'm going to do.
Yeah, but I know what you're not going to do. You're not going to jump on my couch or I'll break your arm. So now the story is your marriage between you and Nicole wasn't recognized by the Catholic Church.
Well, you know...
Maybe your wedding wasn't acknowledged because of your sexcapades with young men. Ooh, did I say that out loud?
I've always been that way. You know...
Or maybe the Catholic Church just ain't cool with that whole Scientology placenta-eating thing.
Listen, I really ate the placenta.
Whoa.
I ate guts.
Ooh.
And I did. I videotaped it so I could go back and look and see.
Maybe the Catholic Church just ain't down with crazy people.
Inside Edition. We'll be right back.
1101 at 560 WQM. Happy Tuesday, July 11th. I got bad news. More celebrity death.
Oh, no.
You know how they always say celebrity deaths come in threes?
Somebody said that. I don't believe them.
Well, they're right. First it was June Allison, and then it was the guy from the Commodores, whatever his name was, that nobody ever heard of. Now, Syd Barrett.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes.
Pink.
Syd Barrett, the treble genius who co-founded Pink Floyd but spent his last years in reclusive anonymity, has died. A spokeswoman for the band said today he was 60.
Ever hear his music?
I didn't know he made any.
His own, yeah. No, it was horrible.
Oh.
You're very lucky.
Oh, kind of like my buddy there. What's his name? Ben Harper.
No, much worse.
Really?
Really.
I didn't know it was possible.
Oh, you have no
the
idea.
Spokeswoman, who declined to give her name until the band made an official announcement, confirmed media reports that he had died. She said Barrett died several days ago. See what I mean? But she didn't disclose the cause of death. He had suffered from diabetes for many years. Uh-oh. He had suffered from diabetes. Barrett co-founded Pink Floyd in 1965 with Roger Waters, and Nick Mason wrote many of the band's early songs. The group's jazz-infused rock made them darlings of the London psychedelic scene, and the 1967 album, The Piper at the Gates of Dawn, largely written by Barrett, who also, 5 years before the release of Pink Floyd's, he also wrote, I think there's a word missing here, Pink Floyd's most popular album, Dark Side of the Moon. He was replaced by David Gilmour, who is not related to Buddy Gilmour or George Gilmour or John Gilmour, even Dougie Gilmour, I don't think. Barrett released two solo albums, The Madcap Laughs and Barrett, but soon withdrew from the music business altogether. I hate Pink Floyd, by the way.
I don't care.
He spent much of the rest of his life living quietly in his hometown of Cambridge, England, where he was a familiar figure, often seen cycling or walking to the corner store. Unlike, of course, some people we know who are like, in their last days, acting really bizarre. Right, Kurt?
Oh, yeah.
Let's see that movie again. Let's watch Last Days.
Oh, yeah. Maybe we missed something.
Right here on the air. Maybe there was something that we missed about the whole
movie. I told you.
Especially that one scene there.
I thought I did, so I backed up the end again.
I especially like the scenes where we watched the leaves blowing in the wind. That was really something. There must have been something symbolic about that I missed, being the stupid old fat
blonde. The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind.
Oh, is that it? I thought he looked a little like Bob Dylan. Despite his brief career, Barrett's fragile, wistful songs influenced many musicians, from David Bowie, who can cover the Barrett track See Emily Play, to the other members of Pink Floyd, who recorded the album Wish You Were Here as a tribute to their troubled bandmate. Band spokesman said a small private funeral will be held, and we'll let you folks know when it's going to be. So all you Pink Floyd folks, you know, just like the people who probably went to Jerry Garcia's funeral.
Same right. Thing. No.
All the groupies,
sorry.
You know.
Sorry.
Every group has got their groupies. If you got a group, you got a groupie. If you got a grope, you got a gropey. Something like that. Speaking of idiots, Dan Abrams, as I started to say before Pink Floyd interrupted me. Boy, they're dying like flies now. It's unbelievable.
I'm dying over here.
Incredible. We got 700 votes yet on the poll, because if we can get to 8 by the top of the hour by noon, I think we got a really solid, solid shot.
Rock solid.
702 rhymes with Jew Lieberman, who's doing pretty well on the poll. Other than the president, your president, what politician do you despise, hate the most? Dick Cheney, 315. Boy, nobody can touch your vice president. Catherine Harris, 71. Jeb Bush, 63. The wildly popular governor of Florida, fat-ass Jeb Bush, 63. We hate him. Liar. Family, a total dysfunctional family. Hypocrite. BS artist. Hillary, 51. Tom DeLay, 47. Jew Lieberman, 34. Rick Santorum, 28. I'm surprised that many people even know who he is, that right-wing lunatic. Ted Kennedy, 24. That's bad. I hate this poll, 22. George Bush, the 1th, 12. Newt Gingrich, 10 for Newty. Rudy Giuliani, 9. John McCain, 8. If they watch that movie, see, they haven't watched that movie, Why We Fight.
They need to. Everyone needs to.
But they won't. Al Gore, 4. Bill Clinton, 4. And John Kerry, only 2. John Kerry comes in dead last. He did win. That's your president, by the way. He won the election, amazingly enough, in spite of his very tepid campaign. But, of course, just like they did with Catherine Harris in Florida, they had Kenneth Blackwell in Ohio, and they rocked the vote. If you can't rock the vote, fix it. Well, they sure aren't fixing MSNBC. They're doing a hell of a job over there, just like our management's doing at QAM. Not. Dan Abrams is shuffling the deck, is what he's doing, shuffling the deck. Because he's not going to be on the Abrams Report anymore, thank goodness. Who is their new anchor on Ed at 4 and 6 in the afternoon? Mother Tucker Carlson, that stupid right-wing Twinkie with a bow tie. Oh, my God. Hey, Tucker.
You fairy.
Pathetic. Just pathetic. The reason they moved him up to 11 o'clock at night is because his ratings were invisible on his show, so they moved him up to when most people are asleep. And now they're going to reward him by putting him on there right in broad daylight when people are awake. MSNBC, the network with a death wish. The only good piece of news is that going off the air will be
Rita Cosby.
Live and direct with Rita Cosby, who's been doing the 10 to 11 slot Monday through Thursday. Hardballs, Countdown, and Scarborough Country remain intact. Countdown is Keith Olbermann. The 10 to midnight slot Monday through Fridays will be MSNBC Investigates, an expansion of the MSC and Dateline documentaries, which have seen some ratings improvement during Friday nights. Oh, you know, they have that on all weekend. I like those shows with John Singenthaler. Have you ever seen any of those?
Yes.
Yeah, some of those are pretty interesting.
Mm-hmm.
But my God, they're on all weekend. That I just don't get it. That would be like us putting the crow on from 7 to 10 tonight because the All-Star game is on. An act of lunacy. An act of self-immolation. An act of self-destruction. We have a death wish. Even Charles Bronson can't believe this radio station. We got a death wish, baby.
Boom.
3 hours. 3 freaking hours of the crow.
I like that one.
Oh, my God.
How about Yub and Amoeba, Trobe, Meeb, the Blob? Okay,
no, thanks. This was not a decision driven by the ratings for Live and Direct getting her off the air. And then they're talking about she's going to be on MSC and she's going to do all kinds of crap. This will actually enhance Rita's visibility throughout the network, Abraham. I told you this guy's a jackass, Dan Abrams, and they put him in charge. It would be like putting Clarence in charge of QAM or Robert Grieper or both of them. An act of lunacy. An act of total irresponsibility. 719 votes on the poll. Oh, I think we're going to do it today. That would just keep me going right through the summertime if on the 11th of July. Now, do you want to hear this Ted Rall column or not?
I do. Oh. Love Ted Rall.
Well, we got people dying, man. It's more important when we hear that.
I'm dying over here.
I mean, Pink Floyd and the Commodores and God only knows what it'll be. Maybe even the 1910 Fruit Gum Company, somebody from that group will die. We can only hope.
Don't say that out loud.
Ted Rall writes, Gates and Buffett 1,000 times worse than Ken Lay. He says, Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, and Ken Lay, all thieves. Compared to the world's two richest men, however, Lay was small potatoes. So why are we praising them and kicking Lay while he's down, 6 feet down? Yeah, I watched the documentary, Enron, the smartest guys in the room. Lay and his sidekick, CEO Jeffrey Skilling, used bluster lies and a bunch of fictional Excel spreadsheets and an updated Ponzi scheme to create what appeared to be the nation's seventh largest energy company. Even when the truth that Enron had negative net assets was about to come out, Lay continued to talk up his BS company and its fraudulently inflated stock. Shareholders, many of them employees whose retirement savings were invested entirely in Enron, believed his reports that the company's finances were solid.
Rock solid.
Meanwhile, while he lied through his teeth to thousands of men and women who would be ruined because they believed him, he secretly cashed out millions of dollars of his own. Federal prosecutors say that Lay and Skilling illegally bilked Enron out of $183 million, including company bonuses paid during their conspiracy to pump up the company's stock and Lay's use of its line of credit to pay off millions in personal debt for such items as a $200,000 yacht for his wife Linda's 2001 birthday party. When Lay died last week of a heart attack, having been found guilty of fraud that led to the 2001 collapse of Enron, he had been awaiting sentencing. The New York Post noting that Texas law may protect Lazer State from forking over the $43.5 million the SEC had sought as restitution. Restitution, that sounds like a good song.
Let's play it.
Published one of its instant classic front pages, pictures of the deceased executive and a coffin under the headline, "Before they put Cheeto Lay's coffin in the grave, check he's in it." How do you like that? New York Post, "Before they put Cheeto Lay's coffin in the grave, check he's in it." True, Lay was scum, but the I Spit on Your Grave Act is a new phenomenon. Cruel and avaricious titans of industry typically receive the kid gloves treatment when they pass out of the great equities desk. In 1989, Stephen J. Ross, chairman and chief executive of Time Warner, paid himself a record $78.2 million, more than 9,000 times the average salary of his employees, thousands of whom he had cheerfully laid off the year before. When some cynics mentioned that Ross's victims might be jumping for joy at the news of his 1992 death from prostate cancer, they were universally and loudly denounced as rude and unfeeling. Lay stole $43.5 million. Ross overpaid himself at least $78.2 million, worth $121.9 million today. Now consider investor Warren Buffett and Microsoft chairman Bill Gates, worth $44 billion and $50 billion respectively, according to Forbes. Each one has accumulated 1,000 times more cash than Ken, number one Bush campaign donor Lay. But we're supposed to like and even admire these rogues. Buffett and Gates may not have broken any laws, although in Gates' case, the Clinton-era Justice Department thought he cheated millions of American consumers by violating antitrust laws, but it's hard to see how their billions are more ethically legit than Lay's misbegotten millions. Sorry, but working hard doesn't cut it. I don't care if you stay late at the office every night, work weekends and holidays, or never go on vacation. It doesn't matter how smart, imaginative, or lucky you are. It just isn't possible to earn $44 billion in a single lifetime. Not honestly, anyway. Gates and Buffett have created a lot of pain and misery on their way to earning their combined $94 billion. Bear in mind, that's what they're worth. That doesn't include what they've spent. Gates scammed his dough the old-fashioned way, overcharging his customers and underpaying his employees. Somewhere along the line, accumulating $50 billion, doesn't it occur to a guy that he could charge a little less than $200 for buggy, instantly obsolete software? Or that it's time for a company-wide raise? He could even hire gas by unionized American workers instead of building plants in the third world and relying on the slave labor of prison inmates. It's harder to draw a direct line between Buffett's convoluted arbitrage machinations and the reduced incomes of thousands of other people, but anyone who's been downsized by a shareholder-terrorized managing board has experienced the impoverishing of the workers whose employers he targets. Now we're supposed to be shocked and awed by Buffett's decision to give $37 billion, about 85% of his assets, to Bill Gates' foundation. Stunning in its generosity, raved the Christian Science Monitor. The scale of Mr. Buffett's philanthropy is matched by its good sense, chimed in the Washington Post. Recent grants paid out by the Gates Foundation include $100,000 for the museum at Pearl Harbor, $241,500 to provide sustainable public access computer hardware and software upgrades to libraries in L.A., and $21 million to provide curriculum and support for teachers as part of a transformation that aims to prepare Chicago public students for success in post-secondary education. Good causes all, but maintaining Pearl Harbor is one of the reasons we pay federal taxes. Why does the National War Memorial need help from Bill Gates? One can't help wonder whether L.A. libraries and Chicago schools might be less cash-strapped in the first place if so much of our society's wealth hadn't been monopolized by America's tiny, increasingly powerful oligarchy rather than going to city taxpayers in the form of fair wages and affordable computers. Factoid. The average member of the Forbes 400 list of richest Americans has seen his income raised 3.5 times from $800 million adjusted to 2006 to $2.8 billion in the last 20 years. Meanwhile, the real income for more than half the population increased zero, nada, zip. To his credit, Buffett acknowledges the rising income disparity. What has gone on in this country in recent years is a huge benefit to the very rich, and not much the relief to those below, he told Fortune in 2005. But philanthropy won't slow the U.S. slide into third worldom, and it doesn't help the philanthropist's victims. All things considered, a $45 million tout like Henley hurts America less than a $44 billion one like Bill Gates. Consider a burglar who boosts your TV and, in thinking better of it, donates it to an orphanage. His act of generosity beats the alternative, keeping it for himself, but you'd probably prefer that he returned it to you, or better yet, didn't steal it in the first place. That's your buddy Ted Rawl. How do you like that? Picking on poor Billy Gates.
Great. This is Neil Rogers. This
and Jimmy
is
David Warren Buffett.
It's a lie. I am not a Nazi.
Tired of watching news with a bias? And watch the news channel that keeps insisting it's fair and balanced, even though anyone with an IQ over 4 can see it's not. It's Fox News, with a powerful primetime lineup so powerful that we're going to keep repeating the word powerful as much as possible. First at 8, it's the O'Reilly Factor.
Whoa, 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 whoa. Now, you've said 2 sentences, and I have not interrupted
well,
you.
Well, Bill, if I could just
No, you don't. I'm not letting you get away with that.
Then, at 9, it's more debatable debate on Fox News. Hannity and Combs discuss the issues of the day at the top of their lungs.
Tonight, the subject, Hillary Clinton. Is she a crazed, twisted liberal or just a vicious, conniving bitch?
Well, I...
shut up, Ellen, you commie!
Then at 10, Fox News presents The Edge with Paula Zahn. We don't know why she has a show, but she sure looks good.
Tonight on The Edge, we'll examine why George W. Bush is the greatest president in the history of the universe. And we'll hear from both sides, conservative Republicans and liberal Republicans.
Fox News, the coverage is always fair, accurate, and balanced towards our point of view on Fox News. Fox News, we distort, you decide.
Faster than we expected.
Yeah, okay. 745 votes on that poll, baby. We're going to make that 1,000 today if it's the last thing we do. And then we got Bo Camper, Kimba Bo Camper, coming along too with that big moo cow from Dan Dowd's that's now in front of a University Dodge. What the hell more could you want? And Mad Dog, 3 solid hours. There's no Marlin game because we got the All-Star game, and we don't have it. We ain't carrying the All-Star game. Who the hell would want to have that when you can have the crow on from 7 to 10, right?
Right.
I mean, what are the chances? You notice even on that ad we got, that embarrassing ad for salespeople for our boiler room back there, it says if you're one of those people that wants something about sports, you're
upset. You love the smell of sweaty jocks.
That's what, if you like taking showers with guys naked like Josh does with his male roommate. And to this day, I never realized that you live with some guy. I thought you were shacked up with that Russian chick.
No, man. Need the space. Space is good. Space is good.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, at least about 2 feet between those beds. That's why he's so nervous about watching that show.
Yeah.
The Supernaturals. That's why I get so nervous. You know, it strikes too close to home. I always liked that Hillary, man. Wait till you hear this. You're going to love this.
All right.
I probably should take some calls if we ever get any. I don't know, maybe one or two. Because your report hasn't been too uplifting, plus only being on these few hours, you know, every week. Mm-hmm. I got to make the most of it, baby. I got to make the most of it right here.
That's right.
India train blast. Well, 70 people dead, but they got over a billion people over there. So, you know, what's 70 more? Right? That sounds insensitive and a terrible thing to say, but do we know what the... Oh, there's that Anderson Pooper, man. He sends me straight to the pooper. Oh, God. He is such a fruity-looking thing, you know. Hey, Anderson.
You fairy.
God, he just... Well, what is the big deal with him? He's the new heir apparent over there at CNN.
He's got
They're
connections.
They're almost as bad as MSNBC. What?
He's got connections.
And that must be it. In the sack. In fact, maybe their two beds are not a few inches apart. Maybe they're like connected. Maybe it's just one big one. Maybe a big queen size. U.S. Senator Hillary Clinton took a shot at Secretary of State Ken Blackwell of Cincinnati, the Republican candidate for governor yesterday during her third visit to Ohio this year. Wasn't I just talking about Ken Blackwell in the stolen Ohio election in 2004?
Yes, just.
Speaking to more than 3,000 people at a national conference of ACORN, the Association of Community Organizations for Reform Now, ACORN. Isn't that cute?
Very.
Do you ever eat chestnuts?
Not that I can recall.
You know,
probably.
In the wintertime, you know how they have, like, weenie stands in big cities all around, you know, hot dogs and sausages,
and
like we have here.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire?
But they have, yeah, chestnuts roasting on an open spire in Italy, in Rome.
I'm sure I've had them.
No, I don't think I ever ate. Maybe when I was a kid, I ate chestnuts. I remember the smell of them. Ooh. Anyway, at the National Conference of ACORN, Hillary prompted whoops and hollers by saying, let's make sure that we count every vote in our elections. What a concept. You think they got service in Mexico, which they do. Clinton also called for an increase in the minimum wage. If it makes the Ohio ballot November 7th, voters will be asked to approve raising it from $5.15 an hour to $6.85. Well, let's see. You figure it out. $5.15 an hour, just narrow it off to $5. That's $200 a week for a 40-hour week. Who the hell can live? That's $10,000 a year. Even Josh Cordes is making more than that.
Yeah,
not much more.
Just a tad.
A couple of bucks. Referring to presidential races, Clinton said, this country deserves to have an electoral system that has integrity. I know there's been a problem here in Ohio, and I hope everybody from Ohio is watching this election like a hawk. Don't let them pull anything over your eyes again. Without naming Blackwell, Clinton said, one of the people running for high office is actually running the election. That should not be permitted as a conflict of interest. We got to take back our democracy, she'd be saying. Carlo Lopero, spokesman for Blackwell's gubernatorial campaign, said Clinton is welcome to come to Ohio in November, and we'll make sure everything is handled on the up and up. Yeah, up yours, Carlo. Remember what happened to Carlo in The Godfather?
That's right, won't see him no more.
He got in the car on the way to Vegas, and all of a sudden he found Clemenza in the back seat. He got Leif Garrotted. We'll even pay for a flight, Lopero said, as long as Clinton stands right next to the Democratic candidate for governor, U.S. Representative Ted Strickland. Clinton was in Ohio last month to raise money for Strickland, and U.S. Representative Sherrod Brown, candidate for U.S. Senate. She also criticized the government's hurricane response last year and federal cuts in tuition assistance. But you know something about her? I'm still going to say the same thing.
Yeah. Sure.
She ought to be working at the Waffle House.
She's a leaf on the wind, since you were just talking about her.
Yeah, that's correct. She's a leaf geared on the wind. 700 and some odd votes on the poll, 755, and we're still alive for that 1,000. They hit him with 18 shots and he's still alive. I just love the way Celezzo says that. They hit him with 5 shots and he's still alive. You remember that?
Oh, yeah.
He was good, Celezzo. Virgil Celezzo. But we don't know who the actor was. I think he's dead, isn't he?
Probably.
Eli Wallach, though, is still alive. That's the bad news. Boy, I can't get over that. I usually try not to hold a grudge in life, but in his case, I'll make an exception. Even Sophia, I mean, you know, she can't help it that her daddy was the director of the movie, and that daddy also had his daddy conduct the music. It would not that there was any incest in there, speaking of Hillary.
Sure.
Incestuous relationships, man, that's what it's all about. A tempest in a peapot. That's how June Allison would have described it. Of course, everything to her was a peapot. Yeah, that movie, Rear Window, really sucks. You know, I hate to say it. No, listen. 1954, back in the day, kicking it ancient style, that's the way movies were. Very slow and very artsy-fartsy, and we saw a lot of close-ups of Grace Kelly, which she was pristine, man. She was just gorgeous.
Yes, she was.
And what the hell she was doing with Jimmy Stewart, I have no idea. He didn't seem to be the least interested anyway, with or without the broken leg, without the cast in
that's right.
He didn't seem too interested. He was more interested in watching Raymond Burr.
Peeping.
Well, Raymond Burr, you know?
Gay.
What does that tell you, with binoculars?
Al Lettieri. Lettieri. Virgil Celezzo. See.
And the sad part of it is we don't have any Celezzo drop-ins. All of the stuff. We do?
I don't know.
We don't have any Celezzo.
Glaring omission.
We do have this.
Local brass, he sleeps with the fishes.
Right. According to a story in today's New York Times, Representative James Sensenbrenner, the powerful chairman of the House Judiciary Committee, Republican of Wisconsin, is the primary impediment to George W. Bush's plans for immigration reform, according to Raj's story. The Times says of him, Sensenbrenner, 63, can be neutrally described as a Washington piece of work, a big-bellied curmudgeon with a taste for old caddies, pontoon boats, and enormous cigars, big stogies. He's equally at home discussing policy minutiae or the disgusting details of his Dalmatian's recent intestinal problems. See, now, ordinarily we'd have some sound effects there, but we can't do it.
Yeah.
Surprisingly, Democrats on his committee praise Sensenbrenner for his fairness, efficiency, and willingness to heed their concerns. His conservative populism often rubs House Republican leadership, many Senate Republicans in the Bush White House, the wrong way. He's emerged as the chief promoter of the House's enforcement-first approach, emphasizing border security, criminal penalties for illegal immigrants, and sanctions against employers who hire them. The congressman, described by even his friends as prickly, cantankerous, and unpleasant, has no tolerance for illegal immigrants. He even uses a do-it-yourself car wash rather than risk having his Cadillac cleaned by someone of uncertain national origin.
Mm.
And he's made... he probably would be asking for their papers, for their birth certificate, their passport, and whatever.
Let me see your papers.
And he has made clear his refusal to compromise with the Senate and the President planned to offer immigrants a path to say, you go, Jimmy, you go. Illegal means just that. Lawbreakers, you don't belong here in the first place. Go back where you came from, okay? And quit pouring across the border. Reminds me of that movie, what the hell was that movie? My Tutor, with Matt LaPanzi and Olivia Newton-John. No, she wasn't in the movie. She was his wife, briefly. After she told everybody she was a dyke on The Tonight Show. And that Matt was a LaPanzi, something like that. Don't see him no more. That was a pretty cute movie, My Tutor. You saw it, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Nothing wrong with that movie. And you remember the illegal aliens who were like the housekeepers?
Yes.
Who pretended no speak English. That sure reminded me a lot of South Florida, you know? A lot of that going on. Oh, no speak English, unless, of course, you're talking about me or it becomes necessary at the moment.
That's right.
27 past 11.
Incredible.
At 560 WQM. Finally, a TV experience like no other. Take it from me. Comcast Digital Cable with On Demand is easy to use and lets you take viewer control to a whole new level. With Comcast On Demand, TV is on your terms because you can select a show on your schedule and pause or rewind it whenever you'd like to. And for a limited time, you can get connected to Comcast Digital Cable and HBO On Demand for just $34.99 a month for your first 3 months. Why is TV so much better with On Demand? Well, I'm glad you asked. For starters, you can watch over 3,000 free movies and shows whenever you want. It's a revolutionary new way to enjoy TV. On Demand is ready to start when you say so, with programming including free movies, kid shows, music videos, cooking shows, sports, home improvement shows, guitar lessons, and so much more. You'll always have something good to watch right when you want to watch it. You sure can't get all this with satellite. So ditch your dish today and get big savings up to $515 plus On Demand so you can build your own TV schedule. And best of all, On Demand is free with Comcast Digital Cable. So pick your show time, sit back, and you wonder how you forgot along without it. Call today and order Comcast Digital Cable and HBO with the power of On Demand for just $34.99 a month for your first 3 months. In Dade, call 305-COMCAST or in 954-COMCAST. Call today for full details. Certain restrictions apply.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QA.
I ain't never said no.
very annoyed. The Maltese say it, doy. I ain't never said it.
Death toll in India train blast rises to at least 135. Aren't you depressed?
Wow.
What are you going to do now?
Not happy about it, but...
No, of course we're not happy about it. They were probably innocent, hardworking, curry-loving people.
Right. They rode a freight train, but probably never stole one.
Never stole one.
Yeah.
26 till noon at 560 WQM. We're almost at the halfway point today. My God, this 4 hours seems awfully long to me. At least 260 more wounded, too, in those explosions near Mumbai, which used to be Bombay.
Which used to be Mumbai.
Well, and they change it back again. Maybe it'll be a Ceylon again instead of Sri Lanka. Because if there's anybody listening from Sri Lanka, we hate you like poison. Don't take it personally unless you want to. And if you want to, feel free.
I don't think I've ever met one.
Oh, Sri Lanka? Man, they are just, oh.
Yes.
Well, of course, if you look at the map and you see that little turd under India there, India's dropped a little number there, you know, in the middle of the Indian Ocean. Don't get me started on Sri Lanka.
All right.
Anyway, here's some exciting news for you. Getting this all hot off the press, boy. Thank goodness for my computer. See, one thing about me here, I never lose my service like you guys there.
Yeah.
My internet never goes down.
Why is that?
Because I'm here and you're there. Because, first of all, I don't want to say you have Bell South. 782, I think, let's see, we got 12. Yeah, we'll be over 800 by noon. We'll get that 1,000 easy, like falling off a cliff. A federal judge heard arguments in a lawsuit arguing that President Bush overstepped, bloodbath Bush, overstepped his authority when he authorized the use of warrantless wiretaps on Americans.
Absolutely.
The arguments came less than 2 weeks after the Supreme Court ruled that the Bush administration overstepped its authority in setting up military tribunals to try war on terror detainees. Oh, not a great war on terror detainees. Oh, I love that. That's a new catch-all cliche, war on terror. Mm-hmm. Held at the U.S. Naval Base in Guantanamo at Gitmo. Gitmo for your money, or just Gitmo
and
slice his balls off. The ACLU asked the judge in Detroit to rule that the warrantless wiretaps are illegal because they circumvent the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, FISA, which requires the executive branch to obtain a warrant before engaging in electronic surveillance of Americans. Those warrants are obtained in a secret court which has only denied 3-week requests in nearly 30 years.
About 30, man.
And which allows law enforcement to initiate surveillance before the warrant is obtained. And it goes on. So we'll see what happens there. The Supreme Court already gave him the old finger right up the old chute. They stuck it to him, although I think he enjoyed it.
Probably.
What I'm hearing. Wouldn't be the first time. You know that Bush family, man, they sure like to carouse and drugs and coke. And
they were in that frat?
Yeah.
The Bonesman?
788. No, you can't say that no more. The Bonesman, which could be the Kingsman. And you can't say that either because they did Louie Louie, which they're talking about whipping out whatever they're whipping. So, and you can't say that either. So it's like that bit we've got about the fundamentalist Christians. What is that bit called?
Which one?
Oh, you know the one where they come, we can't watch Disney because Disney's, you know, we can't
A Day in the Life of Two Baptists.
Day in the Life, yeah. Well, there's the Louie Louie. There's the Kingsman. Now, what did I tell you? This song was released 150 times and reached number one every time?
Yes. And there isn't a off-color word or notion in it.
Well, that's because there's... See, that again, okay, that's enough. It goes back to all these made-up things.
They couldn't understand what the hell they were saying, so it must have
been people make up a bunch of crap, and all of a sudden they heave it against the wall, and some of it sticks. And that's one of those things where folklore tells us that there are lyrics in that song that are like really bad news. Of course, that also goes back to the period of time when there were a bunch of lunatics trying to censor things on radio.
Right.
And look where we are now, like 40 years later.
Good thing that's over with.
Yeah, good thing they're not trying to censor anything on radio or TV anymore. Let's see, the Kingston Trio. I sure wish I could get the MTA. Oh, boy, where am I going to find that? I guess I'll have to go to the music store.
What are you talking about?
The Kingston Trio. You don't have that. You've got Tom Dooley, I'm sure, but because I know I got that.
Let me see what I got and what I don't got.
It takes a worried man to sing a worried song. I like that. I like the Kingston Trio. And they also did Pete Seeger's Where Have All the Flowers Gone? Reverend Mr. Black. Where Have All the Flowers Gone? Well, I just got the words off my lips.
He's already
cranked that baby up. On Capitol Records, no less.
Where have all the flowers
what
gone?
A talk of it. I can even
very
hear
nice.
The end.
So what do I want? The MTA?
The MTA. It reached number 15 on the charts. Tom Dooley reached number 1. Kingston Trio. See, that was back in the late 50s and early 60s when folk music, all of a sudden, when people started like, and we had the protest songs and Joan Baez and Judy Collins and all of these people and all of these things. As opposed to the, well, I mean, we got a little bit of that today. You don't have MTA, right?
I'm getting it for you. I don't have it.
You have it?
But I don't have it. I'm going to get it.
Protest song written in 1948. How do you like that? I never knew that. Melody based on traditional folk song, The Wreck of the Old 97, as opposed to The Wreck of the Old John B. Sloop John B. The Wreck of the Old Sloop John B. Oh, man, am I losing it or what?
Yes.
Wow. I'm thinking we know we got Sloop John B. Yeah, there it is. See, I gave you like a second or two. I stalled for you.
Thank you.
And talked it up again and nailed it like our
champion.
You
only work as fast as the software, you know.
Okay, that's enough of that Sloop John B. Now, what about MTA? Are you getting it?
I'm getting it. It'll take a while.
Based on the traditional folk song, The Wreck of the Old 90. Well, let me know when you got it.
When you least suspect
it. What am I looking for? I had to forget. Oh, Louie never made number 1.
Kingsman. Really?
Well, that's right above the Kingston Trio. And you know me, I'm easily distracted. The Kingsman, rock group from Portland, Oregon. Jack Ely, vocals and guitars. Mike Mitchell, guitar. Don Gallucci, keyboard. Sounds like a greaser. Bob Norby, bass, and Lynn Easton, drums. After release of Louie, featuring lead vocal by Jack Ely, Easton took over leadership of band and replaced Ely as the lead singer. And we never heard from them again. Well, no, actually we did. Money. I mean, Money was, Now, that's Barrett Strong's Money, right?
Okay.
Don't you remember Barrett Strong did Money? I got it here somewhere if you can't find it. And then the Jolly Green Giant. Same tune, different lyrics as the Olympics Big Boy Pete. Lyrics inspired by the Green Giant vegetable commercials. Ho, ho, ho. Yeah, that would be number 4. There you go. There's Money. See, that's a ripoff of poor, what's his name? Barrett Strong. And also the Beatles did
that
too. They ripped it off, right?
Here's
Barrett. There you go.
And the Flying Lizards did it too. Don't leave them out.
The Flying Lizards done it. But anyway, Louie only got to number 2 with 6 weeks on the chart. And here I thought it was released like a whole bunch of times and made it to number 1 over and over again. But didn't.
I like this.
You like what? Oh, I love Money.
I like Barrett.
Barrett Strong in a medley of his smash.
You don't love Money like Bill Gates does.
Like V. Gates? And what about Warren Buffett? Well, Warren Buffett must not like it too much because he gave away all that cash. So we like him a lot. We still don't like him. So there you go. Barrett Strong. I got that in here somewhere. Got all kinds of good stuff.
Oh, wait a minute, since I mentioned that. It's from the 80s, you know. So many remakes.
Oh, no. Oh!
Oi! Oi!
Oh, my God.
The best things in life are free. But you can give them to the birds and bees.
They must be European.
Who is it?
The Flying Lizards.
Oh, good. Let's Google them and see where the hell they can fly back to. Get them out of here. Put them on some crap. Put them on Martin Air Airline, Martin Scare, some really crappy airline. By the way, if anybody ever goes to Berlin, do not go to the Hotel Berlin Plaza. It blows. You know, I read the reviews. In fact, I put a review on there. Ordinarily, I don't participate in any of those things. But I actually put a review online where you can review hotels as
really?
A service to other. Yeah. And I read the reviews because the hotel I love in Berlin was full this time because of the World Cup. So I took a chance, and I didn't have much choice, and I tried this other place. It's a couple of blocks down, this Kudamm. And this place, man, just horrendous. And so I wrote a scathing, very short, but scathing review, and very accurately. And like it's a step above a youth hostel. And you go in, and there's like a tiny desk, no real lobby, you know, and the elevator's the size of a broom closet.
And were the youth hostel?
They're hostel. I was hostel when I saw the room.
By the way, something.
Yes.
Is there a difference between Charlie on the MTA and the MTA? by the Kingston Trio.
Did he ever return? Well, I know you got it.
No,
it's the same thing.
All right. Well, I'm getting them both.
Let me do the break before you go interrupting me with that. That's a good song, and especially if you ever lived in Boston. See, they don't call it the, what do they call it now?
The tube?
No, it's not the...
Tube!
What is it in Boston? What's the subway called? The T? Is that it? Well, I haven't been there in a long time, but they had changed. But back in the day when I lived there in the early 60s, it was the MTA, the Massachusetts Transit Authority. Was the subway. And that's where the song all came in, about a guy that gets on the subway and he can't get off. Oh, I can't say that.
Mm-mm.
Back in the day, we could say that. In fact, we could have done a whole lot more. But who was on there?
Stuck and can't get off.
Right, that was Charlie on the MTA. 17 till noon at 560 WQM. This may sound crazy, but experts now say you can lose weight in your sleep.
Oh!
According to ABC News and Good Morning America, medical correspondent Dr. David Katz says there's convincing evidence that a good night's sleep can really pay dividends in terms of weight control. Studies point to two hormones regulating appetite, which are in balance after people have had at least 8 hours of sleep. So call Dial-A-Mattress, 1-800-MATTRESS, open till midnight tonight. Save yourself a few bucks and lose a few pounds, too. Dial-A-Mattress offers you 12 months financing, no payments and no interest. Dial-A-Mattress has been ranked number one in the world in customer satisfaction for years, and they offer you all the name brands that you know and love, like Sealy and Serta, Simmons, King Coil, Tempur-Pedic, and Stearns & Foster. I've been using them for years, and I guarantee you this will be the smartest, the easiest piece of shopping you can ever do. Instead of getting all worked up and spending that expensive gas and wasting a lot of time and cash schlepping all over town, just make the one easy call, 1-800-MATTRESS, or click them online, mattress.com. 1-800-MATTRES. Leave off the last S because it stands for stupendous savings.
This is Neil Rogers.
Absolutely.
This is 560 QAM.
Hi, this is G. Gordon Liddy, and they don't come any worse than Neil Rogers.
Kendall Coffee is hocking a China on CNN again. Oh, God.
Rock solid.
Where have all the anchors gone? Disappearing. The network anchors are all gone from my TV. Soon Ted Koppel will be done.
But still, writing is more fun.
The networks will never learn. That's why they're getting burned.
Where has Peter Jennings gone?
Recuperating.
Sam Rather was a liberal bum.
And Bob Schieffer's old.
Oi!
Where has Mr. Brokaw gone? He's watching Fox News at home.
Will network news return? Can network news return?
No.
It's all over, man. And Charles Gibson keeps shaking his head all around like he's got St. Vitus dance in his pants. It's just hopeless. 11 before 11 at 560 WQM. How's the MTA coming with the Kingston Trio?
It's cooking now. Hang on.
Is it really?
Yeah. Go on with something. I'll surprise you.
Oh, you really going to have it?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, you'll love it. Although, you probably... Now, don't give me like 10 seconds of it. Like some of these
other
ones.
No, I'm waiting for it to finish.
Oh, good. 820 votes. What did I say? We wanted 800 by noon, and we'd have it made in June, even though it's July. It's 11th of July, and WQM is still as stale as last year's Mandelbread. Wow. I'll tell you one thing. My mother sure could make some good Mandelbread. Not too much else in her latter years, but... In fact, didn't she once give you some, did you, I don't know.
I don't know if I ever got any of that bread.
It's not really bread. I never had her mandel bread?
Not that I recall.
Hard as a rock, but very good. 822 votes on our poll today, on our prestigious poll on NeilRogers.com. We got 300 and some odd friends there on MySpace. That's a backslash, by the way. I was thinking about that the other day. Not slash, it's backslash. What is wrong with you?
Forward slash.
What is it?
It's just a slash.
That's what the guy said in Hollow Man, too.
Right.
She said, oh, let me get the duct tape. See, now I'm all confused.
The one that leans to the right is the
slash. Oh, the one that leans to the right must be on Fox.
It's the slash, and the one that leans to the left is the backslash.
349 votes. The one that leans to the right is the slash.
Correct.
Well, that's the one we got on here.
That is right.
MySpace. Oh, I think somebody turned the thing around.
Turned the thing around?
Turned the beat around. No, seriously, that was not that. It was a backslash.
Sorry.
Oh, no. I think I saw Gaslight several times. 349 votes. Friends. Isn't that great? Only been on here 30 years. That's like, what, 10 a year? It's not too bad.
You just got on there. Just wait.
I don't understand how that works. So in other words, these people are on. They've got their MySpace accounts.
These are people who
have... The one
have,
good thing about this is that almost all of these people are like living and breathing under the age of 100.
These are people who have pages on there who are also listeners.
Right. So, I know that.
Yeah.
And well, so, 340, that's probably like half our whole audience that we got left now.
What's good is that when other people are looking at their page, they will see your logo on there and go, hey, who's that? What's that all about? And they'll click
on
it.
So in other words, we're still building our audience one listener at a time. And by the way, how about that tremendous, the fantastic promotional campaign by WQAM? You can't complain about our promotions because we don't have any. Unless, of course, we can get somebody to pay some money for it. You know, that reminds me of that whole scam boo that, oh, what a disaster. If you thought the O.J. golf tournament a few years ago was bad and embarrassing, this thing with that disc that Miguel forced us into putting out this year?
Oh,
yeah, that best of, that 30th anniversary. Oh, my God. And then try to, like, suck money out of our clients like Pompano Park. They had them on the verge of handing over $5,000. Oh, that would cover my bad day at Woodbine yesterday. Boy, don't let me go back to those machines, Mon.
Yeah, stay away from that.
I don't mind going to Falls View and Niagara once in a while for a laugh. At least they feed you there, and they give you, like, a nice room and everything, overlooking the falls so you can jump. But Woodbine, the only thing they give you is, like, Ajita. What a place. Oh, and you are absolutely wrong, by the way. I've been waiting for years, although I've had these stories before, and you're still such a hard-ass, you won't admit it. But circumcising men routinely across Africa could prevent millions of deaths from AIDS, WHO researchers and colleagues reported yesterday.
Oh, I never denied that.
Oh, so in other words, you want them to die in Africa, is that what you're saying?
Yes, I do. It has to do with the mucous membrane.
George is organizing a music recording, USA Against Africa.
As a matter of fact, you know that rumor that having sex with virgins cures your AIDS? I started it.
Hmm. They analyzed data from trials that showed men who had been circumcised had a significantly lower risk of infection with the AIDS virus and calculated that if all men were circumcised over the next 10 years, some 2 million new infections and around 300,000 deaths could be avoided. It's one thing to be circumcised, but if they were also circumspect on top of that, that would help as well. Researchers believe circumcision, and you know, that thing about those football players in California and Fresno with the 11-year-old girl, they should be shot on the spot, you know?
Right. Which spot?
Rectum.
I can't believe it.
How can I afford to see my sister in Chelsea or my cousin in Rockford?
What the hell is that?
Just listen.
A new crisis has arisen. The Metropolitan Transit Authority is the MTA is attempting to levy a burdensome tax on the population in the form of a several fare increase. Citizens, hear me out. This could happen to you.
And through the open window she hands Charlie a sandwich as the train comes from the land.
Oh!
Well, let me tell you of the story of a man named Charlie on a tragic and fateful day. He put 10 cents in his pocket.
I played two songs at once.
No, it's not two songs at once.
The MTA.
You don't, I mean, can you be as square as a cardboard box so you don't get it? It's a narration that in the beginning, the song, they're singing in the background, he's explaining what the problem is with their grievance with the MTA.
No, I understand that, but I thought I had fired off.
He had to get off the subway, and he only had a dime in his pocket, and he couldn't get off.
I thought I fired off two tracks at once.
No.
One more nickel, Charlie couldn't get off of that train.
Okay, that's enough.
All right.
That's a good song. It's a great song. Kingston Trio were great, boy. Those were great groups back in those days. The Brothers Four and Peter, Paul, and Harry, and When Harry Met Sally, and good stuff. Joan Baez, that dyke.
Mm-hmm.
Can I get back to my see you're trying? I know why you fired that off now, because you're always trying to rationalize your foreskin, you know.
Okay.
Researchers believe circumcision helps cut infection risk because the foreskin is covered in cells the virus seems able to easily infect. The virus may also survive better in a warm, wet environment like that found beneath a foreskin. Oh, God, in that smegma. Well, so if men were circumcised, fewer would become infected and thus could not infect their female partners. And on a hot day when it's like 87 or 90 degrees in Italy, you talk about grease balls. You don't know where that expression came from, do you? You think it's olive oil. Well, guess again.
So it's Popeye?
The human, yeah, it pops at you. The old Popeye. The human immunodeficiency virus or HIV, which causes AIDS, now infects close to 40 million people, has killed another 25 million. It mostly affects sub-Saharan Africa, and the main mode of transmission is sex between a man and a woman. Percy Sledge is singing it now. Oh, and you know something? We have a bit for every... It's just amazing.
It's the movie everyone is talking about. Meg Ryan and Alec Baldwin star in When a Man Loves a Drunken Pig.
You take this man to be your lawfully wedded husband?
Oh, I'll be yes. Damn straight, my singer.
Oh, Lord.
All right. How do you like that? Percy Sledge.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't hear, that was Otis Redding. I get him confused. It was the same time frame. Otis Redding and Percy Sledge sitting on the bench in Delray. See, there's another one we got a bit. Every day, it's just amazing, like that, where have all the flowers gone? I bet you could knock you over with a fig leaf on that.
Mm-hmm.
There he is, there's Percy Sledge.
I found a woman.
What is that?
Take time to know her.
Oh, yeah. If you say so. Okay, that's enough. Enough of Percy. What kind of a name is Percy anyway?
I think Percy? No.
833 votes on a poll, and it's 3 minutes till noon. Are we proud of that or what?
No!
This audience comes through when you least expect it, you know? Time for a real quick call. WQAM, hello. Okay, that's a good one. That's exactly what I needed right there.
That's
I had about
so
a half
far.
A second. Yeah. Hey, picture yourself cruising the waters of Biscayne Bay at sunset. The Miami skyline off the bow. Miami Beach behind you. But wait, you don't own a boat? Well, maybe that's the best news of all. Because if you call Club Nautica right now, you can rent one and do the smart thing. Call 1-800-BOAT-RENT. The new Club Nautica on South Beach in Key Biscayne will have top-of-the-line seaboats ready for you to rent. Exhilarating powerboats, new models prepped and waiting for you. And they're Sea Rays. These are the Mercedeses of boats. So call 1-800-BOAT-RENT and Club Nautica will get you all hooked up. Join the club at Club Nautica and see even more boat rental after boat rental. They do all the work for you. No preparations, no docking fees, no maintenance, no cleaning up when you're done, no fantastic cost, no hassles whatsoever. Considering the cost of owning a boat, you can't afford not to do it the smart way by choosing the new Club Nautica at South Beach in Key Biscayne. Call 1-800-BOAT-RENT right now. Club Nautica really does set the standard on the seas. Call them at 1-800-BOAT-RENT.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QAM.
This is Mark Morgan. It's the 12 to 1 hour on QAM.
My wife took their car to the mall. She drives my Buick and she's 3 feet tall. I wouldn't ride with her, no way. I said I'd meet her there later today. So I'm just sitting on a bench in Delray.
Oi!
Waiting for the lolly bus to take me away. Oi! I'm just sitting on a bench in Delray. With my friend Pine. Looks like it's time to check my change. Cause the bus fares don't always stay the same. I'm not gonna do what Yetta tells me to do. The driver at her age, she must be insane. Just sitting here resting my bones. Wondering why my wife won't leave me alone. We've talked it over, but I never win. I just wind up schlepping through the mall again. Oi, so I sit on a bench in the rain, waiting for the lolly bus to take me away. Oi, I'm just sitting on a bench in the rain with my friend Chaim.
Damn time. I've been waiting here all damn day on this bench. Where the hell have you been? Hey, where the hell are you going? Come back, you schmuck.
845 votes on the poll. Other than your president, the politician you hate the most, despise, like that, Dick Cheney, 376, hate Dick. Catherine Harris, 89. Jeb Bush, 78, your fat-ass governor, a real piece of crap. Tom DeLay, 59. Hillary, 59, tied with Tom DeLay. In fact, she looks a little like Tommy. You ever notice that?
Now that you mention it.
She also looks a little like, what's her name, Rebecca De Mornay. And every time I say that, you get very upset. I don't know why, because she looks a little like
she
her.
She does look a little. I don't know why you say
I
get upset.
I think she's just as evil as the role that she played in The Hand That Rocks
uh-huh.
Your Needle.
She is. She's evil.
Rick Santorum, 36. Jew Lieberman, speaking of evil, 36. The evil Orthodox Yid. Ted Kennedy, 29. I hate this poll, only 25. Only a paltry 2.9%. They like it. They hated your poll on Friday, man, and justifiably so. Newt Gingrich, 15. George Herbert Walker Bush. Bush Uno, 13. John McCain, 10. That's because they haven't seen that movie yet, Why We Fight. See what a total turnaround he's done, you know, total
How
phone.
How sad. I mean, he's saying all the right things.
Oh, yeah, he says all the right things. Then all of a sudden, look at him now, sucking up to Bush. McCain, 10. Rudy Giuliani right on his ass with 9. Al Gore's only got 4 for Gore. Bill Clinton, 4. And John Kerry, only 3. The fewest people hate John Kerry like poison. But also the fewest people wish, they just don't want to see him no more. That's all. You know what I'm saying? As opposed to some people that we do hate like poison.
Do.
And they want to see no more. Now, that story about the, because I was curious about that. About the Boston Tunnel. 3-ton concrete panels fell from the ceiling of the city's Big Dig Tunnel. I know they've been digging that crap for years. Killing a woman in a car and shutting down a section of the massive building project that's become both a central route through the city and a source of construction concerns and cost overruns. The woman was a passenger in a car hit by debris from the ceiling late yesterday. A man believed to be the driver was able to squeeze out and was taken to hospital with minor injuries. Authorities say safety hasn't been compromised by problems with a $14 billion Big Dig highway project, which buried I-93 beneath downtown and extended Massachusetts Turnpike to Logan Airport. Massachusetts State Police said the stretch would be closed indefinitely while authorities clean up debris and inspect the area. Speaking of turnpikes, by the way, can I go back to the Sun Sentinel? Maybe you can get the story. I'm going to have to go to Firefox. You're right. Internet Explorer is evil.
It's Bill Gates. It's evil. It's the devil.
Well, there you go. I think your buddy Ted Rall had a good point, after all. Okay, let me find the Sun Sentinel. I'm going more and more back to Mozilla Firefox, which I love it anyway, but the fact is I do like my my Alexa emailing.
We'll wean you off that one of these days.
No, I don't think so. It's instant. I mean, you click on that baby, and that's all you have to do. Where is that story? Oh, tanker crash in the SunPass lane. Here it is. Shuts down the turnpike in both directions in Tamarack. Don't you feel we ought to be putting something on the air like this?
Okay.
I mean, since we are your news-intensive informing the public radio station, if it doesn't have to do with sports, we don't want to know from it.
I mean, so they're putting planes into buildings. What are we going to talk about? We got to talk about sports. That's what they're paying us to talk about. You know what I'm saying?
One of the most disgraceful days in the history of broadcasting, and your buddy Gildy was involved. He was the chigger in the woodpile, talking crap on the worst team. 9/11/2001, and you turn on QAM, and they're knocking down the World Trade Center and hijacking planes and flying into the Pentagon, and we're talking about ball games. That's evil. That should have been on the axis of evil right there. Florida's turnpike at the toll booth north of Cypress Creek Road has been shut down in both directions. See, and they talk about me being out of touch. Guess what? Touch this. After a tractor trailer hit a barrier in the SunPass lane and began leaking fuel, the FHP said today. No injuries were reported in the 10:30 accident this morning near mile marker 63, but some fuel was spilled from the tanker's 9,000-gallon load. It was spilled. The rig was formed by firefighters to foamed by firefighters to prevent any chance of fire or explosion. Another tanker is being brought in to offload the fuel left aboard the rig. Of course, that was at 10:30. Well, it's just noon now. You know, these things take hours. Trooper said the accident occurred when the tractor-trailer rig braked to avoid hitting a car that had stopped in the SunPass lane. The rig hit a barrier, gapping the tanker and spilling some fuel. Traffic is shut down in both directions between Commercial Boulevard and the Pompano Beach Service Plaza. Not known how long the fuel offloading process will take. And this story came across the Sun Sentinel Wire 11:52, 60 minutes ago, so you can bet your life on it, pretty much, that it's still shut down.
Oh, yeah.
Okay?
Probably a nightmare.
There's
over
a little
there.
Word to the wise for you there. They got debris falling in Boston from the damn Big Dig Tunnel, and now we got the turnpike shut down. Near Tamarack, where all the old farts are, or at least some of them, anyway. You can never say where all the old farts are in South Florida.
Right.
Realizing a year and a half, a little over a year, I'm going to be a senior citizen. Oh, won't that be exciting if I make it that far? Wow. I'm extending my contract, by the way, until I croak.
Okay.
856 votes. Well, I got a lot of people to keep alive. You know, I got to keep the old checks coming in.
That's right.
Put on this facade. Put it on. 856 plus what else have they got? You know, take a look. Pop Hat Janko, look what we got. Oh, my God. We got Kim Bocamper at 2, Mad Dog 4-7. He's always
rock solid.
But then, after that, because we don't, it's the middle of the summer. Who the hell are we going to put on the air, okay? We probably, what's his name ain't available now? Flea?
Oh, I don't know.
But we do got
Manny Ramirez.
The Crow from 7 to 10 tonight. The most, just when you think it can't get any more embarrassing. In fact, let me take a look. I don't usually pay too much attention, especially during the summertime, because I'm not on that much anyway, but Let's see what we got on Saturday. Oh, 8 to 9, we got Saturday Lenny Martez in the morning after the Nationwide Golf Exchange. Then we got 3 hours of that. Then you got the big,
oh,
who's really
rock solid.
And then 4 to 5:30 Saturday, again, you got more to crow. Talking hardballs before the Marlin Astro game. Oh, my. And then you got, after the Marlin game, Sporting News Radio. Oh, are you kidding me? The game is a 6 o'clock game. It'll be over by 9 o'clock. Well, you ought to be in the studio on that day because you know what they're going to do?
I give up.
When the game is over, they're opening the pot. Maybe you can get some of it.
All right.
No, they just open the pot and put on. I mean, this is, you know how I look at this? I view this as total surrender.
Sure.
It's like putting your hands up in the air and saying, okay, we give up. Not to anybody else, and certainly not the guys across the street. They're like invisible. But just in general, you know, in terms of competitive nature, we're just.
This.
What is that?
Not me.
I'm just trying to wipe some dust off of the thing there. I fired that baby off, man. Got all. Whipped up into a frenzy. Man, talk about just absolute surrender. I guess what we're figuring is that who the hell wants to hear a Marlin game on a Saturday night, so after we're just putting on that Sporting News crap. That, because we don't want to pay somebody to be there.
That's right, and it's sports.
It's another cost-cutting measure, okay? We certainly don't want to pay a flea or that mission mosh and pish and posh. Speaking of pish, by the way, June Allison died. Many imports of canned tuna. Oh, I sure hope it's not that chicken of the sea, or what's her name? Jessica Simpson get all upset. Many imports of canned tuna have mercury levels higher than the federal limit, according to an analyzation by an environmental group. This is just a little word of the wise out there, those of you people eating all that fish, loaded with mercury. You know where it goes from mercury all the way to Uranus.
Yes, it does. Quickly.
Defenders of wildlife found the high. You know, actually, when I was a kid, they used to say that, and then they changed it to Uranus. That shows you how uptight America
is. Yeah, well,
is.
I
you
still know, say Uranus.
It used to be Uranus.
Still is.
Well, nobody else can claim it. Defenders of wildlife found the highest levels of mercury in tuna from Ecuador and Mexico, countries known for setting nets where they see dolphins catch the large tuna swimming below. They tend to catch larger, more mature fish, which tend to have higher levels, being at the top of the food chain, said Bob Irvin, the group's senior vice president for conservation. The group is a longtime advocate of dolphin-safe tuna. Well, what does that mean, dolphin-safe tuna? I don't understand that.
That means catching tuna usually means killing a bunch of dolphins in the process.
Well, isn't that nice, okay?
But dolphin-safe tuna, they take care and special attention.
I sure hope they don't mess with Jason Taylor because his wife is dumping his ass. The group had a lab test, 164 cans of tuna labeled as being from Ecuador, Mexico, Costa Rica, Thailand, Malaysia, the Philippines, and U.S. Tests were done by New Age Landmark Lab, a Benton Harbor, Michigan company. Don't ever go there. That's been used by the federal government. Analyzation of the samples found average mercury content of U.S. tuna was generally lower than imported tuna. Tuna from Asia had the lowest average levels of mercury, and tuna from Latin America had the highest mercury levels, with some exceeding the government limit of 1.0 parts per million. That's like the rating across the street, 1.0 per million. That's how many people they got. And considering there's like, what, 4 million people in South Florida, they got 4 listeners over there. The lab found higher levels of mercury even in light tuna, which the FDA considers to be low in mercury. How do you like that? Bunch of lightweights. The FDA says it's safe to eat 2 meals a week of fish and shellfish that are lower in mercury, such as canned light tuna, shrimp, salmon, pollock, pollock, and catfish. What the hell is pollock? Pollock?
Sorry.
P-O-L-L-O-C-K. I never heard of that.
I'll go order some now.
What kind of a fish is that? Pollock. But the agency says to limit albacore or white tuna to 1 meal per week because it contains higher levels of mercury. Oh, that's... In other words, if it's got mercury in it, don't eat it. Just quit eating that tuna, man. Quit eating so much tuna. Right?
Sorry.
This business of don't eat tuna, I don't eat it. I can't remember the last time I bought a can of tuna.
I won't eat it out of a can anymore.
How about tuna? 12:13. Oh, no. At 560 WQAM. How many votes we got? We're going to do that 1,000 today. Over 135 dead ends. It's a terrorist attack, by the way, India. That's what they're saying.
Yeah.
You know what everybody's thinking, don't you?
I give up.
In all the countries, in the U.S., England, everywhere else, they're thinking better than us.
We have
no ash to grind with them, although we did cozy up with the Pakis, which is a bad mistake, with that Musharraf guy. 866 votes. Oh, we got that 1,000. Look, Josh is going to write it down on his wrist and tell his boyfriend, I mean his roommate, when he goes home. Now, does he listen to the show?
Yeah, off and on.
Does he really? And what does he say? Got caustic comments to make or what? How old is your roommate?
He's 26.
Oh. What's he doing? What's a guy 26 doing with a roommate?
Well, we're
saving money, I would imagine.
Sounds like gay to me. I mean, I can see you, but I mean, 26, that's just like one step away from a 30-year-old guy living with mommy.
Well, maybe he's 25. Well, either way.
In other words, you don't like get him a birthday gift or something like that, keep track of when his birthday is?
No.
Now, what's so bad about that?
Nothing, but
they're not that close.
It sounds a little... Yeah. I understand. How long have you lived with this queen, this guy?
Like 2 months.
Oh, 2 months?
Yeah.
Well, for all you know, he might... better watch it. Now, you guys have separate bedrooms, of course, because you're very uptight about guys who have, like, beds in the same room.
Of course.
Now, does he, like, ever sneak in there, like, at 2 in the morning?
No, never.
That you're aware of?
Doesn't get lost.
Doesn't come wandering and say, oops, I'm a little, Josh is the one that always comes home drunk, so I guess we ought to start investigating that. 1215 at 560 WQM, you know, Brandy's is unbeatable. That's why Brandy's shoe store has been around for a zillion years while the others have come and gone, man. How'd you like to have $1,000 for every shoe store that's come and gone in the last 20 years?
I'll take it.
In South Florida. I'll take it, too. The only place to take your Tootsies is Brandy's in Pompano Beach. They carry all the top brands like Florsheim, Echo, Mephisto, Rockport, Hush Puppies, New Balance, all the other name brands in all sizes for men and women. They even carry wide widths and hard-to-find sizes. If you want the perfect deal all the way around, the best fit at the unbeatable price, then go see our buddy Arnie, who'll get you the right fitting shoes for your feet. Brandy's is located at 1290 North Federal Highway in Pompano Beach, right between Atlantic and Copas on the east side. You can't miss it. Open every day of the week, Monday through Saturdays till 9, and Brandy's is even open on Sundays till 5. And the Red Tag Sale event continues this week at Brandy's. Thousands of pairs on sale, famous brands, men's and women's styles to save you a lot of cash. So get your ass into Brandy's this week or do your shoe shopping online at brandyshoes.com.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QAM.
They get.
Here we come, yo. Here we go. Here we come, yo.
Evan Cohen here on WQAM. That was my obligatory rap song open to familiarize myself to you, the listening audience, on this, my live audition on the air. Many thanks to Clarence and Grippa for a delightful dinner and date last night. That was a wild grind under the Shaquille O'Neal poster over my headboard. I say Shaquille O'Neal in order to distance myself from those who just say Shaq in an attempt to establish my own identity. So thanks, fellas. You say I have the gift of gab as opposed to being ungifted in other ways, so let's talk intensive sports now, shall we? It provides nebbish yiddies such as myself an opportunity to feel accomplished in something they never could accomplish in their lives. Even in high school, when I would hide under the bleachers from the bullies and ogle the jocks, sneak into the locker room to inhale yellow laundry. I am glad to be sitting down after last night with Clarence and Grippa. All day I have been walking like William Boyd. We'll be right back with more broadcast professionalism after these words from Astroglide.
The following program is brought to you by
Astroglide.
Now, what's he trying to say? That Evan is for the Boyds? Is that what he's saying?
I don't know.
877 votes on a poll. We got that 1,000 licked. Oh, my God. What the hell was that?
Rectum.
Oh. Speaking of that, your fat-ass governor, Jeb Bush, has frequently said he won't run for president in 2008, but he's never ruled out being on the ticket as somebody's running mate. Oh, God. And he didn't yesterday when asked about teaming up with Arizona Senator John McCain as Republicans hope to come up with a ticket to keep the White House. I like Senator McCain. I think he's a good guy, Bush told reporters after returning from a holiday in Maine with his obnoxious family, with his grave-robbing, crooked-ass family, with his coke-snorting family, with his butcherous bunch of, crooks. Any potential GOP nominee would covet the 27 electoral votes in Florida, where Bush enjoys a high job approval rating among voters because they're crazy. They're like that. They're lunatics. They're out of their mind. It was the 20th, yeah, we know that. Bush 53 would also provide some age balance because McCain turns 70 next month. When prodded about the likelihood of a McCain-Bush ticket, Bush hedged just slightly. There's all sort of time to worry about the 2008 election, he said. Because he can't run again for governor and his brother can't run again for president. And thank God in both cases. Thank the,
God.
The Lord. When you say thank Tracy Lord?
Indeed.
260 people wounded, at least 135 dead in an injured terrorist attack on train platforms. Oh, look, and they keep showing that one bloody guy there. He looks not too good.
Bloody.
Now, this soccer stuff, I don't know whether I should waste my time, although we'll have to go. Josh will have to help me with this because you're the expert.
Okay.
You'll have to call up the big.
Oh!
That's why you're on at 5 o'clock in the morning, Orlando, and not on between 2 and 4 when people are awake because you talk too much soccer crap, okay? And because you're a professional Julio. You see, the English-speaking audience, I probably, you know, I've mentioned this before, and I'll say it again. The English-speaking audience resents that whole deal. They don't want a Radio Mambi in the middle of QAM, okay? They don't want that. They don't want some militant Julio on the air thinking that everybody in the world should be speaking Spanish and talking about soccer and guayaberas and crap like that, okay? So 5 to 7 in the morning you are barely adequate for, so just stay there.
Oh!
You know what I'm saying? Big O? The last thing we need to hear about is soccer on the radio. How are the Strikers doing, by the way? Let's see, how many incarnations have there been of soccer teams in South Florida? There was the Fort Lauderdale Strikers. There was the Miami Toros, right?
Mm-hmm, the Fusion.
Right?
This is Ray Hudson, Miami Fusion's head coach, and I love the Queen of South Florida, Neil Rogers. Should be in Buckingham Palace, but we'll keep him here.
Yeah, keep him here. He was a good guy, Ray Hudson.
Yes, he was.
He was funny.
A fine man.
He was a fine man, which goes to show you there's an exception to every rule. And he was the exception. With his monkish mien, backed by a sense of brooding menace, and I have no idea how you say his name.
Zinedine Zidane.
I believe.
I'm pretty sure.
Zinedine Zidane.
Right, yeah, like I said.
You were close. You need a vowel movement. Let us know when you're leaving. You'll know when he runs out of there screaming. Zinedine Zidane has always been something of an enigma. So it is perhaps fitting that, just like, what's his name? Robert Duvall says in the movie, what's that movie? The Great Santini.
Oh.
He says, I want to be an enigma like a chink. Remember that?
Yes.
To the daughter. She says, Dad, I want to get to know you. He says, I don't want you to get me, I want to be an enigma like a chink. That's a good movie, very underrated. Now, did you ever see that?
Talking to you, I've seen
it. No, I have not.
Oh, and let me write these down. Fatso, and you will like that. I guarantee, if you don't like that, there's something wrong with you.
Would
you agree, George?
I do agree. He's a big fan of good comedy.
Well, but it's not all comedy. Great Santini?
No, I'm talking about Fatso.
Oh, no, but I'm talking about Great Santini. I know he'll like
it. Oh,
Fatso.
No, I think he'll like it.
Yeah. Robert Duvall, and what's her name? Oh, God, I love her. She plays plays the wife.
She plays Jesus?
No, she plays his wife in there. Oh, my God. She's, what's her name's mommy? You know, that was married to Tom Green?
Right.
No, she's not. Well, what is her name? Oh,
I'll find it.
Google the Great Santini, okay, because this is going to drive me nuts.
Blythe Danner.
Blythe Danner. Who am I confusing her with?
I don't know. Bliss Danner?
No, who's what's her name's mommy?
Rosemary's Baby?
No, who's the actress that married Tom Green for about 5 minutes?
Drew Barrymore.
Oh.
Drew Barrymore, okay? Now, don't tell me Ethel Barrymore. Who am I getting confused with? Is Blythe Danner got a daughter?
She might.
Anyway, she played the wife in a Great Santini. Who?
Blythe Danner is Gwyneth Paltrow's mother.
That's who I'm talking about, Gwyneth Paltrow. What is wrong with you? God.
I smoke a lot of dope.
That must be it. Anyway, can we get back to Zinedine? I don't know who these people are. They all look alike. After a while, all like blend. It's like a blur, you know? It's like a big blur. Just why did a man blessed with complete control of a football lose? First of all, there was no football in that game, okay? It's a soccer ball, and it looks to me like a very small one, too.
It's a football.
No, it isn't. No, this is spelled with two O's, so that's not right. And this is in the British Times online.
Mm.
Lose his head in such a violent manner at such a crucial moment, boring into the chest of Marco Materazzi. As L'Equipe, some French paper, summed up the moment of madness with a headliner, Regrets Eternals, a day of endless questioning began. With many conflicting versions of the events circling on the Internet and the world's media, the Times enlisted the help of an expert lip reader, Jessica Reese, to determine the precise nature of the dialogue that caused Zidane to react in such a manner. And I'm going to give you the skinny on it in a minute here, after we do the break.
Oh, good. I need
including
to know.
Some words that we can't. Yeah, well, they even asterisked them out in the Times Online. You know, those stodgy Brits. 27 past noon at 560 WQAM. We got 8, oh, look at that, 892. We'll have 900 by the bottom of the hour. We'll go over 1,000 easy, man, like sliding off a log. Understand that Abe Lincoln, remember the old log cabins? I understood he slid off many logs.
No, he was a tall man.
With lightning quick speeds, the latest features in security, Comcast high-speed internet leaves DSL in the dust. Call today and get yourself the best offer of the year and add Comcast high-speed internet for only $24.95 a month for your first 6 months. Plus, Comcast will upgrade to the super-fast 8-meg premium speed tier free. With an always-on connection speed of up to 8 megabits per second, Comcast high-speed internet is up to 5 times faster than DSL 1.5 and 100 times faster than dial-up. Nobody in their right mind is still doing dial-up. It's like men's two-piece bathing suits. It's like knickers. It's like white bucks. Whether you're downloading music, watching streaming video, playing online games, or just surfing your favorite sites, Comcast reliable fast connection means you'll be flying through the internet. Plus, when you sign up for Comcast high-speed internet, you get instant access to free features like video mail, Comcast Radio Rhapsody Plus, and up to 7 personal email accounts, just to be naming a few. Not only that, but you also get free McAfee security tools included, so you can rest assured that your internet experience will always be safe and secure. An annual savings of over $100 for the security alone. So what are you waiting for? Start doing more faster than ever before. Sign up for Comcast high-speed internet today for just $24.95 a month for 6 months. Indeed, call them today at 305-COMCAST or in... 954 Comcast. Call for details today, and don't forget, certain restrictions apply.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QAM.
Close call, and the society ball. Took a streetcar one way with the girl from King Kong Fei Wei. She arrived at the door, she was looking poor. Only made a dime a day, 15 cents was minimum wage. She was gonna be an actress, just like Vivian Leigh. Live on a plantation and drive a Model T. She thought that Al Capone was the enemy. But she knows that nothing has been all right since Al Jolson and Chaplin, way before Gay Chaplin, Charles Lindbergh, the Duker, the president was Hoover. There were no TVs and no I Love Lucy. She's still preoccupied. 1925.
It is now apparent that the Republican ticket of Harding and Floyd is running well ahead of Thurston Roosevelt. At the present time, Harding has collected more than 16 million votes against some 9 million for the Democrats.
She knows all the classics. She knows every line. She puts Gone with the Wind, drinking on Mickey Finn. She did the Charleston to Duke Ellington. Or how her mind would whirl when she dreamt of Milton Berle. She wore an outfit like a flapper. Held a prohibition, she could have no liquor. She loved the comedy shows like George and Grace. Whatever happened to having
You fairy.
You know, I'm inspired. I inspired myself with that Rear Window. I'm glad I watched it again last night.
All right.
Because... you know, they talk about movies or TV shows that hold up over a period of time, you know, that are still entertaining and still enjoyable years later.
Right.
As opposed to some things that were like period pieces that were very enjoyable, you know, during a period of time.
Right.
But you watch them again years later and they seem camp or silly or just unentertaining. How's this for a great poll question for Thursday? Don't you dare steal it.
Okay.
Something or someone that seemed better years later than it really was. Isn't that
okay.
A great poll question?
It's a good idea. They'll
be a, huh?
Well, you're going to fill in all the answers, right?
I'm gonna start with some, of course, like we always do. Well, what does that mean?
Oh, because they never answer the question right when it's something like that.
Could be a movie, or it could be a TV show, it could be a
person,
food,
place,
it could be
thing.
Yeah, person, place, thing. All of these things.
Right.
You know, like the first team on QAM. 26-1 at 560 WQM. You're stuck in the mud station. Don't be a stick in the mud. Well, we are. We're stuck. You know, I might as well take this once. WQAM. Hello. Was there any doubt?
None.
Zero. Anyway, getting back to Zidane. After an exhaustive study of the match video and with the help of an Italian translator, Reese claimed that Materazzi called Zidane the son of a terrorist whore before adding, just F off for good measure, supporting the natural assumption that the Frenchman must have been grievously insulted. As the son of two Algerian immigrants, the 34-year-old is proud of his North African roots. See, what did I tell you about that French colonialism again in Africa?
Mm-hmm.
Dedicating France's 1998 World Cup win to all Algerians who are proud of their flag and those who have made sacrifices for their family but who have never abandoned their own culture. So such a slur would certainly explain, if not justify, his violent response. When asked about the allegations on his return to Rome, Materazzi issued a vehement denial, while sources close to the player emphasized that he had not been accused of racism ever before, pointing to his close friendship with Obafemi Martins, the Nigeria and Inter Milan striker. A lot of strikers out there on the pitch. What a stupid effing game, man. It's just pathetic. It's absolutely not true, Materazzi said. I did not call him a terrorist. I'm ignorant. I don't even know what the word means. The whole world saw what happened on live TV. Zidane was understandably keeping his counsel, but his agent, Elaine Miglaccio, indicated that he responded to extreme provocation. The Real Madrid midfield players expected to break his silence in the coming days. Well, who gives a crap? Real Madrid, my ass. As if that made any difference, as if France was going to score a goal. Although I guess he was one of their top penalty kickers. Maybe that was the kicker there at the end. Maybe they'd still be kicking it because those goalies sure as hell were. You know what it reminds me of?
What?
We were talking about this last week, about like lacrosse, where they run up and down the field, and they have those little like butterfly nets, and they have they have that little ball in there, that little pelota, and they just heave it in the goal. Of course, at least in lacrosse, the goal is small, you know?
Right.
And they just heave it in there, and the poor goalie, he tries to stop it. Like I said, like trying to throw a golf ball in the Atlantic Ocean, it's not really all that difficult, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Unless you throw it back over your shoulder, it's probably going to get in the water, at least it ought to. 906 votes. We're gonna go so far over 1,000 today that there is no stopping us now, man. And we got 352 friends. And I don't care what you say. Maybe it was my fault. Maybe I wrote it on here myself. Maybe I made a mistake on the MySpace thing. Because I think I did forward slash. Or is it, did I do back?
Well, you did backslash.
Well, now I got it right, okay? Just slash, okay? Just slash.
Just
slash. And Axl Rose and all the whole Gatsa Mishpacha. 12:38, 22 before 1. We'd take some calls if we had any, but it's like, you know, see, when you keep pushing for it, what are you going to get?
Oh, you don't have to push.
No. 5670560. Maybe there are, I'm surprised we don't have a whole bunch of people calling in saying, boy, we sure enjoyed that movie. We went out and got that Why We Fight movie with Eisenhower's picture on the cover, and it was fantastic, and everybody ought to be forced to watch it, including the one guy that called in last week who said he had it and he hadn't watched it yet. Wouldn't you think he'd be calling us in?
Watch it twice.
Now, you ought to be watching that every day. Did Josh see that yet? I guarantee you
No,
didn't.
But I have it, so I will watch it very soon.
Even you, even a punk like you, I realize that you're not, you know.
I told him. It's an easy watch. Not boring at all.
No, it's not boring.
It's riveting.
It's aggravating. It's very annoying and aggravating, and all this bloodshed and all these people dying for no reason at all because a bunch of old men.
It's eye-popping and jaw-dropping.
A bunch of old men sending young men out to be killed. That's basically what it boils down to.
Yeah, for money.
That's correct.
It's going to piss me off. Get me fired
We're in
up.
The war business. In Network, in that movie that you hated so much, when he said, the world is a business, Mr. Beale. That's right. The world is in the war business. That's the biggest business of them all. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Hey, how's it going, dude?
Okay, sir.
Hey, one thing you haven't mentioned, the fact that the French captain was named the MVP of the World Cup. The same guy that did the headbutt.
He was?
He was named MVP of the World Cup.
Yeah, who cares?
Well,
get out of here. WQAM, hello. If you're going to start with soccer calls, I'm in the calls right now. QAM.
No soccer calls.
Thank God.
You ever hear a guy who speaks perfect English but with a Latin accent all of a sudden just go into affectations whenever a Latin name?
Oh, sure. Sure. It's just like the newscasters, usually the females that we've had in South Florida for years. Nicaragua. Ana Esquik was famous for that. And also Isabel de Casada. All these affectations, all this. Because they're pandering, that's all.
Well, Big O just, within the last couple of weeks, cut an ad for some sponsor of yours. And he was talking about
rock solid.
The Chacarita. And he's perfect English. And all of a sudden it came to say Herradura Tequila. And he said, Aradura. I'm saying, what is that?
Yeah.
Perfect Chacarita. And I'm like, what the hell? It was like three times on it.
I think if you ever met the Big O, he is Isabel de Casada in disguise.
Well, you know, Neil, the best thing about World Cup soccer was it wasn't in the way. I mean, I'm watching TV and I'm finding
what
the
best thing about it is that it's over.
It's gone. But at least it wasn't clogging up my networks of anything else I wanted to watch. You know, if you wanted to put on ESPN 6, that's fine. You know, or the Importante station, whatever the heck it is. But you know, for those soccer fans, let them watch it. But as long as it stays out of my way, that's fine with me.
Yeah, let those stodgy Brits watch it, man. They're animals anyway. Let them lose their souls.
Amen, Neil.
See you, pal.
Have a good one.
Yeah, he's got a good point there. In other words, it wasn't on every channel like some of this crap. Like Bush, you know, like every time Bush has a fart or something, we got to see it on every damn channel, even the comedy channel. And by the way, I know this pisses a lot of this audience. I don't care. I'm too old to start pandering to people, okay? I don't care what anybody says, but The Daily Show blows, okay?
Okay.
I have tried to watch that so many times, and I told you I saw the episode with, what's her name, Kevin Spacey was on there. You know, one day I'm in, one day I'm out. Kevin.
You fairy.
Who I like a lot. He's a great actor. But in trying desperately, and they don't say, you know, they kind of like hint around. And like I told you last week, the audience is all wired. They're all on acid. They're whooping and yelling like the Arsenio crowd. It's just garbage. And Jon Stewart, I don't know. I mean, does he write any of his own material, or has he got writers?
I don't know. I know that he has writers. I don't know how much he throws in there.
Oh, my God. I know you. That's not politically correct to say that. Oh, Ministry. That's who I got to get. I was supposed to get this weeks ago, and I never went out and got the Ministry song, Lies, Lies, Lies.
I have a lot of Ministry music. I don't know if it's your bag.
No, that's not the point. I'm talking about to play on the air. Neil Young isn't my bag either, but I got Living with War.
Mm-hmm.
You whore. How about a whore for war? That's what we got. That's what the Bush family is. Whores for wars. And your buddy Cheney, too. Whore for Halliburton. What was that?
Oh, this.
I believe the title was Bin
Ministry.
Laden determined to attack inside the United States.
Just to give you a taste.
Well, that was Condom Leisure.
Yes, it
Condom
was.
Condom Leisure.
Just to give you an example of
Nicaragua. Yeah, actually, the big O, I didn't want to out him, but he is Isabel de Quesada in drag. Yeah. I guess they already knew that. Now, he's just annoying is what he is. 918 votes on the poll, and I guess he doesn't get invited to those dinners with Grieper and Clarence and...
Well, he's not Jewish.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that. He's not part of the sports nerd Jewish fraternity that we got. What did you think about that? 1243, and of course, Evan Cohen, that's why he was invited out. He's not only fat-faced and Jewish, but he's also a sports nerd.
Yes,
yes!
Yeah.
And Jim Sarney's got an Evan Cohen blow-up doll. Hey, if you love the finer things in life like Jim Sarney, then you love Stogies, Miami's quintessential cigar shop in Kendall. With South Florida's largest selection of cigars, Stogies of Kendall is sure to have all your favorites. You like them, they got them. Stogies has got over 1,000 open boxes of cigars for you to choose from, including Arturo Fuente, Padron, Monte Cristo, Romeo and Julieta, and lots more. I like the way they spelled Monte Cristo here. Just a beautiful thing. Who is this now? Craig. We got a new guy named Craig in sales?
Yes. Tall guy. Big fan.
Oh, good. Like I said, he's a good guy. Including a large selection of premium cigars at closeout prices, as well as the obscure and hard-to-find brands. Come into Stogies today and enjoy a smooth smoke in their wine lounge featuring some of the finest boutique wines from all around the globe. Join Stogies every Friday for their wine tasting from 5 to 8 in the p.m. featuring some of the most delicious Bordeaux that France has to offer. You know, that's France that just lost the World Cup. You'll find Stogies at 11612 North Kendall Drive, open every day, 7 days a week. Or call Stogies and reserve a box of your favorite cigars, 305-598-9820. And don't forget, when you stop into the shop, say hi to Mario and the girl, Sandra and Yanni. And if you just know their names, you'll get a free cigar of the day just for saying hi and because they have big egos. Stogies, 11612 North Kendall Drive. Call them at 305-598-9820.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QAM.
America loves to watch boobs and butts and boinking.
I hate yard work. First I have to hoe the garden, then I have to mow the lawn. I wish there was an easy way to do both.
Well, now there is. All you need is the new Garden Gnome Homo, the gardening tool that both hoes and mows.
You know, I used to spend hours in the hot sun mowing the lawn and tending the garden until I realized I needed a Homo.
The Homo can suck up those clippings in minutes and drive in a deep hole with one easy flick of the wrist. Before you know it, your gardening is done.
I was working in the yard and I saw my neighbor out back with his big tool. And my husband said, that's got to be a Homo. Who would have thought we'd see a Homo in this neighborhood?
The Homo works in front as well as in the back. And now, with great factory incentives, there isn't a better time to join the happy Homo crowd. Your happy Homo dealer will bend over forwards to satisfy you. The Homo. No home is complete without one.
You fairy.
1248 at 560 WQAM. Happy Tuesday to you. Oh, don't tell me there's a fax coming. What's this? Is this about Ministry again?
Yeah. Since the concert was this weekend, and I was already talking about it, and just thought
I'd mention. This past weekend?
This Sunday night, as a matter of fact.
Past?
This past Sunday night.
Well, let's see. It says Ministry played last night in order.
That's a fact that I had gotten yesterday because I was talking about them. But
Most of the stuff is anti-Bush, anti-Nazis, anti-Republicans. Well, isn't that like redundant there?
Yeah, it is. But you can
Thanks,
see
Paul in Miami. It says Ministry rocks.
By the song titles, what they're all about.
Fear is Big Business,
yeah.
Senior Pellegro, No W, Rio Grande Blood, Great Satan, Waiting, Lies, Lies, Lies.
That means Mr. Danger, you know.
Is that Lies by the Knickerbockers? No.
That's right.
Worthless, Wrong, NWO, NW.
Oh!
Oh, that must be for Orlando.
Mm-hmm.
Now, is that Orlando Bloom or Orlando El Zaquiri? Just One Fix, Thieves, Kyber Pass, So What, Etc., Rained Out, Stigmata, Jesus Built My Hot Rod, Uh-oh, and Psalm 69. Psalm 69, you can't say that. Psalm... Someday, sometimes, I feel that life is passing me by. 929 votes on the poll already. Boy, this isn't even a sweat. We're not even going to break out into a sweat like those greaseball Italians there in the World Cup. Seriously, you go to Italy, which I've been there many, 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 many times. I've been in Milano, Bologna, Firenze, Rome many times. And, yeah, you see some people that look like that, but there are different... I'm going to tell you who is the epitome of what that soccer team looked like, and that's the Italian goalie, who's supposed to be the best in the world, by the way.
I'll take it.
First of all, he looked about 50 years old. Oh, and speaking of 50 years old, Josh would know this. There's a guy... What the hell? I was watching a little bit of a baseball game, I'm ashamed to say. It was the Marlins and the Mets.
Okay.
Over the weekend. And the Mets have got a guy who, and next month, will be 48 years old.
48? Oh, Julio Franco.
Yeah. That's it, Julio Franco. Just another Julio.
Yeah, he's actually...
He is 47 years old.
He can still do it, man. He can still do it.
Next month, he'll be 48 years old.
He says he's going to play till 50.
Like Satchel Paige.
Right.
Charlie Reese in antiwar.com. That's the website he writes for. America, Government of Cowards. Oh, amen. Back in the 1970s, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, one of the giants of the 20th century, gave a commencement address at Harvard. It was, I believe, the last public address he gave in America. His criticism was so dead on that he quickly became persona non grata. I've always thought that it's a permanent disgrace that this great man, whom many Russians credit with bringing down the Soviet Union, was never invited to the White House, while all sorts of two-bit communists and other poltroons have been fated and dined there. At any rate, apropos of the current headlines, one of the criticisms he levied was that we as a country had become cowards. He made it clear that he didn't mean the American people. He meant the American government and the American establishment. He said they bullied small and weak countries and appeased the powerful. That was true then, and it's true today. Look, for example, at the contrast between George Bush's rhetoric directed at North Korea and his rhetoric directed at Saddam Hussein. Saddam, he said, had been given enough chances. He had run out of time. There was no point in any more talk, blah, blah, etc. Saddam, of course, didn't have nuclear weapons or even chemical or biological weapons. With North Korea, the president says, we must seek a diplomatic solution, and diplomacy, of course, takes a lot of time, etc. and so forth. Gosh, we hate to see North Korea so isolated. What's the difference? Saddam was weak. His regime was a toothless old hag, and Bush and his war hawks knew it. We could bully and invade him without fear. North Korea, however, is a regime with very sharp teeth. It has a fully equipped standing army of more than 1 million men. It has artillery wieldery along the demilitarized zone. Even without its missiles, nuclear or conventional, war with North Korea would produce casualties in the tens of thousands and would do it in a matter of days. So you're darn right Bush wants to use diplomacy, though his diplomacy is so inept that it's not likely to work. We're not going to attack North Korea or even try a surgical strike, and North Korea knows this. It has a deterrent sufficiently strong to persuade us to let the sleeping dog lie on the Korean Peninsula. You'll notice, too, that all the tough rhetoric about Iran has suddenly quieted down. I think both the U.S. and Israel have finally realized that we have no military option with Iran. Iran is in a position to cause us unimaginable problems all over the Middle East. Our failure in Iraq and the Israelis' failure to cower the Palestinians have reminded both countries that the Middle East is not a good place to cause trouble. It is a place where conventional forces can win tactical victories, but not strategic ones. T.E. Lawrence, or Lawrence of Arabia if you prefer, noted a characteristic of the Arabs. They can be suddenly seized with an idea so passionately, he said, that they will willingly lose everything for it. That's all the explanation you need for suicide bombers. There is a line in their psyche that Westerners would do well not to cross. At any rate, our government and our establishment remain as cowardly as they were in the 1970s. Look at the great military triumphs in recent years, invading Panama and Grenada, bombing Libya and Serbia, fighting two wars with Iraq. Any general who wanted a triumphal procession in Rome after victories that petty would have been limited to a single cart pulled by a donkey. Probably we don't have a real peace movement in this country because one isn't needed. We're not going to fight anybody who has half a chance of drawing real blood. We're never going to launch a preventative war against North Korea or Iran, and God knows not against China or Russia. Perhaps if Bush ever extricates himself from Iraq and Afghanistan, we might have another go at Somalia. We are, just as Solzhenitsyn said, the bully of weak countries and an appeaser of strong ones. Amen to that. But
very
then
nice.
Again, huh?
I said that's very nice.
Yeah, it is. 941 votes on the poll. Other than your president, which politician you hate the most? Dick Cheney, 414. Hey, Dick, don't shoot anybody now. Watch it. Old duck hunting Dick, 414 votes. Catherine Harris, 99. Oh, my God. If you heard about her plane, you wouldn't believe what it's doing right now.
What?
Burning. Fat ass Jeb Bush, your governor, 90. You know, it's interesting when Fox News, remember they had that court case and the court ruled that they can make up news, they
make
can make up, stories
that's
whenever
right.
they want. Yeah. But of course, if you happen to be to the left of Attila the Hun, you can't do that, or you ought to get fired for it.
Mm-hmm.
Jeb Bush, 90, your fat ass governor. Hillary, 67. Tom DeLay, 64. Rick Santorum, 43. Mr. Fetus Hugging Fag Hater. Jew Lieberman, 40. Talk about drag. There's the Connecticut drag queen champion. Jew Lieberman. Now, what's this? What's the website where these kids are making up the... Oh, geez, I wish I would have written it down. They're making up phony political ads. Did you see that last night?
No.
Oh, it's great. And the one for Lieberman is he's talking. It's his voice, but they got Bush moving his lips. They got Bush standing there and Lieberman talking. It's a beautiful
thing. I pay money.
They're making up phony political ads, and they're better than the real political ads. Maybe that was on Keith Olbermann. Jewel Lieberman, 40. Ted Kennedy, 33. I hate this poll, 28. Newt Gingrich, 17. George Herbert Walker Bush, 17. Not to be confused with Bandar Bush. John McCain, 11. Rudy Giuliani, 9. Al Gore, 4. Bill Clinton, 4. And John Kerry, still only 3. How do you like that?
I like it.
Well, that's our crowd, you know. That's our commie pinko liberal crowd, thank God. Our heathen crowd. Oh, we did a fabulous job in Afghanistan. The letter pinned overnight to the wall of the mosque in Kandahar was succinct. Girls going to school need to be careful for their safety. We will put acid on their faces or they're murdered, and then the blame will be on their parents. Today, the local school stands empty, victims of what amounts to a Taliban war on knowledge. Remember how we wiped out the Taliban in Afghanistan?
That's right. No more problems there.
Right. The liberal wind of change that swept the country in 2001 is being reversed by the conservative estimate of Afghan president and Unocal stooge Hamid Karzai. 100,000 students have been terrorized out of schools in the past year, and the number is certainly far higher, and many teachers have been murdered, some beheaded. Oh, no. Those barbarians, just like our good Saudi buddies with those beheadings. In the province of Zabul, a teacher and female MP, Tour Pelikai, said yesterday, there are 47 schools in my province, but only 3 are operating. Only 1 teaches girls. It is 200 meters from a large U.S. military base in the provincial capital. Across the south, schools burned during the night, according to a bleak report, just like Catherine Harris's plane. According to a bleak report released by Human Rights Watch, today at least 200 schools have been destroyed in the past year and a half. Their blackened shells, many of the new buildings constructed with foreign aid money, are visible from ever more dangerous roads south of Kandahar. And it goes on and on. We did a fabulous job, just like we always do in Afghanistan, hit and run. And the Taliban are back, and of course the poppy deal. And then we had that story last week. Did you see it about how Karzai's brother is one of the top poppy drug lords? I Poppy?
No, I didn't see that.
Oh, yeah. Hamid Karzai's brother. Yeah, he's just a farmer, you know, he's growing his crops.
Sure, what's wrong with that?
12:57 at 560 WQM. Lobster Fest is back every Friday through Sunday at the Emerald Coast, the best Chinese buffet in South Florida. 3 locations for the Emerald Coast are in Sunrise, Pembroke Pines, and Sunny Isles Beach. Over 100 different items featured on the Emerald Coast buffet, so try them all. Go in there with an empty stomach, and by the time you walk out, you'll be waddling over there. Start out with 6 gourmet soups, then go for the New York steak, grilled to order, juicy and delicious the way you like it. Hand-carved prime rib. They have a sushi bar and all the traditional Asian dishes, as well as a salad and bar. You won't even know what to eat next at the Emerald Coast. Just shovel it all down your puss. And their dessert bar is spectacular during the week, and on the weekends, even more spectacular. A 40-inch chocolate fountain will make your mouth water. You'll be drooling all over yourself. As you hand dip strawberries, marshmallows, cheesecake, other decadent treats, and loads of milk chocolate for dessert. A perfect ending to a fantastic feast. Even the Romans would be embarrassed. At the Emerald Coast, which uses only healthy cholesterol-free canola oil, and no crap, no cornstarch, no MSG. So bring the whole family for a fabulous feast real soon to the Emerald Coast. Call them at 954-572-3822. And don't forget, every Friday through Sunday, it's Lobster Fest back at the Emerald Coast, where you can eat to your heart's content without spending a lot of green. 954-572-3822. Sounds Irish to me.
This is Neil Rogers. Rock solid. This is 560 QAM.
I don't listen to the 1 to 2 hour. It wouldn't be prudent at this time.
Man who had a talking car, now drinks too much while at the bar. He is tall with lots of wavy hair. Give a step to the left, a step to the right, and try to pick a fight. I'm doing the Hawk. I'm doing the Hawk.
Who wants to fight the Hawk?
He was in the movie Click and likes to drink until he's sick. He's working on a rap album, that's true.
All right, who wants to hear my rap album?
If I stagger to the left and stagger to the right and try to pick a fight, I'm doing the Hawk. I'm doing the Hawk.
I am Michael Knight, let me in the bar.
Yeah, I'm doing the Hawk. Does anyone have a beer? Yeah, I'm doing the Hawk. I just broke the chandelier. Germans around the world are doing the Hawk.
Everybody
do the Hawk. America has talent, yes, but why does David have success? Some people wish that he would go away.
Yes. But if I fall to the left and fall to the right and try to start a fight, I'm doing the hop.
Is it sidewalk
crooked? I'm doing the hop.
Mike, please stop doing the hop.
I'm doing the hop. I'm doing the hop.
I'm working, Michael.
Boy, is he a talent or what?
No.
No, I can't stand him. It's 103 at 560 WQM, and boy, am I the best or what?
Yes.
Guess what's on the way to you guys?
I give up.
It will be delivered tomorrow.
I'm thinking.
Fatso and a great Santini.
Oh, okay.
Well, not for you, but for Josh.
All right.
They are coming to you, but you're going to have to turn them over.
I'll make copies.
Well, that's what it says. Now, how the hell can they do that? It says order date July 11th and delivery estimate, shipping estimate July 12th. That's tomorrow. Because I ordered one-day shipping.
Well, that's one day.
Paid big bucks. Well, you know, these are very inexpensive. When you order old movies from Amazon, they're like, you know, $6.99. I mean, the price of these are embarrassing. They're almost for free, you know. Fatso and a Great Santini, guaranteed. If you don't like both of those, I'll be shocked. Shocked.
All right.
There's nothing slow or ponderous about either one. Just another great line in the Great Santini. Tumor's in trouble. Well, you'll get it. In fact, you know what Toomer should have said, George? He should have been in Fatso.
That's right.
He should have been the one saying,
"Get the honey, Junior."
Yeah. Well, you'll get it when you see it. It's good. 963 votes on a poll. And then the kid that played in there, now what the hell is his name? Michael O'Keefe, is that him? Whose father was an actor? I liked him in that movie. He was good. And more ways
Michael
than
O'Keefe,
one.
You're very
and
right.
Then he was in some horrible movie where he played an Atlanta Braves pitcher who was married to some rednecky trailer trash broad. I saw about 10 minutes of that movie. It was horrible.
I think that's The Pitcher's Wife.
Is that the name of the movie?
I'm looking it up.
The Pitcher's Wife?
The Slugger's Wife. I'm sorry.
Oh. That really was the name of the movie?
Yeah. And
well,
I think
horrible
we were talking
movie.
About
it.
It
was just, I don't know.
Yeah, Rebecca De Mornay was the...
oh, was she really? Well, no wonder he looked so depressed and beat up. Yeah. Rebecca De Mornay. She was good in there. That's a good movie. I've seen that about 20 times now. The Hand That Rocks the Cradle.
It's good.
You don't like it?
I like it.
Has Josh seen that?
Yeah. It's okay.
Oh, it's okay?
Yeah, it's good. It's fine.
On a scale of what? On a scale of 10, how many stars have we given that? I give it an 8.
I'll give it a 7.
Okay. George?
Yeah, I'll give it a 7. I agree with that.
Oh. I mean, it's not why we fight.
No, but nothing is. And I'm a hard ass anyway. You know that.
Well, watch Outfoxed. Well, that's your next one. Some of those other ones in there, like, you know.
Be watching it today.
The one about Iraq. That's pretty much a rehash. Also, somebody recommended Fog of War, which was on my documentary channel over the weekend on the cable. I saw about the last 45 minutes of that. Save your time. Save your money and save your time. Get Why We Fight instead. If you're into that, you know, if you want to, like, learn a little bit of something. Because Fog of War is basically Robert McNamara just going on about how he and LBJ screwed up during Vietnam and how Johnson didn't know what the hell to do. And, you know, and he's in denial. One time he's in denial, and then another time he's like, yeah, I screwed up. It's nothing. Just him rambling on about the 58,000 American kids who came home in body bags. 6 minutes after 1 at 560 WQM. Oh, don't tell me there are actual calls coming in this hour. I sure wasn't planning on it. 567... 0560. In fact, during the summertime, you know what the best thing is? Never plan on it.
Right.
And pound 560 in the Verizon and Singular wireless lines. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Hey, how you doing, sir?
Okay, sir.
I got a movie I want to mention to these guys.
Okay. Yeah?
Yeah, Frailty.
Frailty, didn't we see that? We talked about that. We saw
it
and we talked about it.
It's great. We all love it.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic, fantastic. I listen to you guys quite often. I never heard you guys talk about Frailty. It's a hell of a movie.
I bought it.
We'll talk about it again. Thanks a lot, pal.
You're not the only one buying movies. I bought that just so Josh could watch it.
It's good.
It is. I want it back so I can copy it for people, too.
And I apologize for Rear Window, but then again, it was my money, and yeah.
That's right.
I didn't think it was horrible. Good ending.
It's not.
It would have been a really good, like, short movie.
But it is so slow,
yes,
you know, and there's so little going on. Although it was good that Thelma Ritter was in there. She kept giving Jimmy Stewart back rubs, but... there just wasn't an awful lot going on, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then again, you have to wonder about the character Jimmy Stewart played, because he's sitting there with his, you know, he's like a captive audience, and Grace Kelly keeps, like, smooching, and, you know, she's hot to trot, and he's got the binoculars on, he's looking at Raymond Burr.
Yeah.
I mean, what does that tell you?
Yeah.
Maybe that's why he talks like that.
Even when she pulls that little nightie out of her little purse.
Yeah, out of her little suitcase. And then his detective buddy comes by, and is, you know, he's looking at the, it just was very slow. It was fine in its day, 1954, a long time ago. That's 52 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to say I actually saw that in the movie theater. Well, how old would I have been? I would have been like 12 years old. Why would I have seen that? Well, back in that day, we didn't have like no R.
Right.
Although not that there was nothing in it, you know?
No.
There was no language and there was certainly no sex. Grace Kelly wanted there to be, but Jimmy was busy a little looking.
What, you look over
there.
Remind
me a little bit of Billy Vivid from Cuckoo's Nest. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Yeah, can I speak to Neil?
Speaking.
Hey, Neil, how you doing?
Okay.
I haven't been listening to it for a little bit. I was wondering if you could comment on the Luongo trade if you haven't already.
Oh, well, what's there to say? I mean, it's, kiss of death. The organization, man.
Yeah, it is. I'm an ex-Blackhawk fan. I mean, not ex, but they've been so horrible for so long.
For so long, yeah. And you want to know why? Because they're cheap, because Bill Wirth is a cheap bastard and they got a horseball organization.
Oh, they're awful.
Yeah.
All right, Neil.
Good luck to you, Pally.
Hey, George did an awesome job while you were gone.
Well, what do you mean while I was gone? I'm gone all summer long. I'm only on twice a week. He's doing a fine job. And that pull on Friday, man, that put him over the top.
Thanks, Josh. I thought it was a fine idea.
What? Oh, was Josh's
pull.
Idea?
Well, he saw it on ESPN, too. It was the same pull that I was going to take.
It was an article. I hate this pull. Overwhelmingly, I hate this pull, which never happens.
Yeah, I'm sure
that
was a popular vote that day.
But I'm relieved to find that a lot of it didn't, you know. And just moving along. Mm-hmm. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Neil, great to have you back also.
Yeah, huh? You're fading over here. WQAM, hello.
QAM. Hello?
Yes.
Is Neil there?
Speaking.
Is Neil there?
Hello.
Hello.
Is Neil
hello?
There?
Hello.
Is Neil there?
Hello.
Why do you keep saying hello?
Because you're talking to me, and I keep telling you it's me, and you keep asking, is Neil there?
Oh.
She's listening to the radio.
Yeah, you're listening to the radio. I'm back. Take that thing and shove it down the toilet, that radio.
Wait a minute.
I'm waiting.
I wanted to tell you about a great place called U2.com where they have wonderful political cartoons.
Okay. U2, that's the letter U as in like the...
Y-O-U.
Oh, Y-O-U. I was hoping it wasn't good.
A T-U-B.
Cube.
What is it? YouTube.
Cube.
YouTube. Cartoons.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
I'll check it out. Thanks very much. Hello?
Hola.
She was great. YouTube.
Yes, was.
What is it?
YouTube.com.
All right.
You know all about it.
Yeah, we've checked
every video in the world's on there.
Okay, just relax now. She was very nice, and we actually had a lady call in, okay?
Hey, we'll take it.
It's the first one in about 2 years that we've had on this show. Although we do have almost 1,000 votes already. You guys ought to be just 969. I didn't put this poll on until about 10 o'clock last night. 972. I think FedExed it. Yeah, I faxed it. Whatever that thing is when you stick it in the machine. I faxed it to Eric at about 7, and of course around 10 he finally got it on there. He's busy, man. He's still got those fireworks going for the 4th of July. Those fireworks he was like creating there at the Parliament House in Orlando. 972 votes on the poll. We'll make that 1,000 by the bottom of the hour. I'm confident of that. Aren't you?
Oh, no doubt.
That guy, what's his name from the Pentagon? Barbara Starr? That's a guy on CNN. Is there any doubt?
Process in place that will...
See, in that deep voice. That's a guy.
Looks like Carl Nelson Reilly.
In fact, you remember years ago... Now, I don't know if you remember this. Mary's in North Miami. Mary's Restaurant on 441. Remember I told you years and years ago I lived at Twin Lakes Racquet Club?
Yes.
At 441 the Golden Glades there? And there was a fabulous... I mean, it was really excellent. It was a tiny restaurant called Mary's. We used to get pizza from there all the time and go there and eat. And there was a waitress in there who was a transsexual.
Okay.
With hairy arms.
Are you sure it was a transsexual as opposed to a transgendered person?
What? Anyway, I mentioned that on the air, and the person called in on the air one time. The
person.
Guy. The
person.
Person.
That's
yeah,
good.
That's a good way to say
words,
it.
Yes.
The person called in on the air. And then, of course, eventually with the changing neighborhood, that Mary's long gone. Mm-hmm. That was a tremendous
What
play.
Did the person call to say? Thanks for noticing.
Hi. I don't know. No, it's just saying that they worked there and they listened all the time. And it was, don't start knocking poor, they got their issues, man. They got their issues. Oh, at least 135 didn't injure, man, in that deadly. Oh, and New York City increases transit security in the wake of India. And by the way, you know what I forgot to mention today? That whole thing about the plot for, this is what the media does because your government continues with a fear tactic, okay? That whole business about, and I did put an article on there, which I'm sure Josh saw over the weekend, about that so-called plot to blow up the tunnels in New York. the Lincoln and the Holland Tunnel. Bunch of bull crap. It was just like the Miami 7. They had no materials. There was no real plan. It was just some internet bravado by some guys who they would have liked to have done this. And, you know, not even in the planning stages or the thing. Just talking out loud, as your buddy would say, Bill Dreck. Out loud. That's it. Just a bunch of crap. But no, they've got to continue to convince America that we're right on the verge of some. And now this thing in India, they're already exploiting that. Be afraid. Like that bit we got, you know, like that thing says.
Be afraid. Be very afraid. Be very afraid.
That's the one.
That was nice.
14 past 1 at 560 WQM. For years now, I've told you about a really tremendous place to take the whole gang for an enjoyable meal, and that's the Melting Pot. They got fondue restaurants all over town now. If you haven't been to the Pot for a while, now is definitely the time to go back. What's not to like about the Pot? It's a full four-course dining experience. Starts out with a renowned cheese fondue, and they serve up three different breads for you to dip and dunk and enjoy. Granny Smith apples. You know, that's always one of my favorite combinations is apples and cheese.
Mm-hmm.
And crisp veggies, too. Next comes your choice of lively salads. And your entrees include a combination of lobster, filet mignon, Cajun seasoned chicken, pork, duck, portobello mushrooms, and lots more cooked in oil or broth. And don't forget the Melting Pot's homemade dipping sauces. They really make the fondue experience fun. That's the key to the whole deal. You're not just eating a meal, you're dipping and dunking in the food, too. And here's the clincher. Top it all off with their famous chocolate fondue desserts with fresh strawberries, bananas, pineapple, cheesecake, brownies, and tasty marshmallows rolled in crushed Oreos or graham crackers for dipping, only at the Pot. My blood sugar goes up just 50 points every time I just think about that. You'll find a Pot all over town. There's a Melting Pot in Coral Springs, North Miami Beach, Cooper City, Fort Lauderdale, Kendall, and, of course, Boca Raton. Be sure and tell them that old Neil sent you by for a really fantastic experience at the Pot.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QAM.
Neil God.
Goodbye, Ken Lay. We're dancing on your grave. They all to pave it over with the roadside truck a stop to give everyone a chance to squat in a screaming tribute that you're gone for a urology. And in these times of seeing justice always fail, here's the only way we'll see it prevail. You'll find it difficult how to spend your money now. I hope they bury you face down.
Wreck 'em.
To be followed by the rest of your Bush crime family hoes. It would be thrilling if Jeff Skilling would drop dead too. You were a well-connected, crooked executive who is now a lump of worm food.
You failed.
119 at 560 WQM. We got 996 votes. We'll have, like I said, before the bottom of the hour.
Senate floor. We paid down the debt.
Oh, there's Harry Reid, who finally somebody woke him up. They tapped him on the back of the neck and woke his ass up. Boy, the Democrats are so lame, man. They're so lame. Guess what I just got on my email? I got an email
what
from?
What you just got?
Amazon.
Oh, saying it's on its way.
We'll be there tomorrow.
Wow.
How the hell do they do that? It's already at 1 o'clock in the afternoon when I order this stuff, and it'll be there tomorrow.
Right, they run a tight hand. Ship.
They're great. I'll tell you one thing, man. And you see how much for the DVD? $6.99.
Wow.
For the Great Santini and for Fatso, because they're old. You know, they're like
correct.
Not great demand. So it's $6.99. In fact, I'm spending more for the one-day shipping than
right.
I am. The two DVDs together are $13.98, and the shipping and handling is $14.97. So $28.95 about
30, man.
I can handle it, even after yesterday. Even after so many bad machines, man. But there you go. So it's on the way, and you'll have them tomorrow.
All right.
I'm telling you, even your roommate might enjoy them. 900. 997. Oh, man, we don't want to overdo it and get over that 1,000 too fast. We wouldn't want to, like, 998. See, they're pouring in by the ones. Now, that's got to be the whole audience, doesn't it, at this time of the year on the 11th of July? Based on what you're telling me about, there ain't nobody around, nobody in town. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Neil, have you seen the movie called The Everygees?
Nah. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
I have I was listening to the show, and you were talking about that transgender person at the restaurant.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, just for kicks, have you ever thought about doing, like, a poll, like, what's your favorite, like, movie drag queen?
Favorite movie drag queen? Like, how many are there?
Well, there's quite a few. If you really stop stop and think about it, there's actually quite a few gone back, like, to the 60s.
Such as?
Well, let's see.
Some
Like It Hot. Remember Jack Lemmon? He was a drag, right?
Oh, you're talking about people like Milton Berle, people who dressed up in drag?
Yeah, like that.
I mean, Jack Lemmon wasn't a drag queen. He's somebody who played a role. He was in drag.
I meant like a role in a film. Yeah,
think it's a bad pull. 567-056, don't you?
I never would have thought of it.
Well, that doesn't make it a bad pull.
No, that's true.
Although I'm really relieved that Josh is the one responsible, because that's not his responsibility, his pull ideas.
Yeah, but I thought it was a good idea.
My suggestion is don't do it again. $9.99, the next person who will be our 1,000th vote of the day, and that person we thank you profusely, but you're not on there yet. I keep refreshing it, and it ain't happening yet. Have you got 1,000 yet? Because sometimes you're ahead, although usually I'm ahead. I keep refreshing and clicking.
$9.99.
That's what I got, $9.99. And I clicked it again and again. They're just holding back, you know. Still, I've clicked this thing about 7 times. Mm-hmm. I clicked this baby. Clicked my BIC.
But if you turn it upside down.
Oh, no. 6-6. Yeah, let's get off of that real fast, man. El Anticristo is at it again. That lady is right. You are the Antichrist.
Yes, I am.
Still $9.99. Maybe this thing is frozen now. Have you ever seen anything like this in your life?
No. Maybe Eric took away the 4-digit
capability. Yeah, I think Eric just kind of like froze it on us, you know, to put us in the kind of QAM mode. Everything is like in frozen and suspended in time. 1,001!
1,002!
Wow. That is shocking. Well, that took a little while there, I'll tell you. Now, ordinarily, when there would be like more than 2,000 people in town, we'd have gotten that immediately. We'd have been up to 1,010. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But we're playing with, like, I think considering everything, we're doing just fine. You know, everything is relative. And considering the fact that, the numbers around us are, like, almost invisible, especially the ones between 2 and 4. How'd you like to be? If I'm Mandage, I'm screaming at them, like, I already told you I do 2 to 5. Just get me on there now, you know, instead of following 2 hours of dead air every day.
Mm-hmm.
With all due respect to Bo and that, you know. I mean, take a look at those numbers, if you can find them. They all begin with a,
oh,
holy moly. I still say that if anybody would have ever told me that during the era that we're on this radio station that we could have had a number in the middle of the daytime, forget about like overnight or late at night, in the middle of the daytime when people, most of them are awake and living and breathing as much as they ever do, and that we could add a number that began with a,
oh,
I'd have said, you're crazy. We could put Grandma, we could put Joyce farting on the air for 2 hours and do better than that.
Oh, aren't
we? Don't. Well, in fact, maybe that's part of the new format. Maybe as soon as we can iron out Joyce's farting problem. Or guess who we're going to have come on and do it?
Who?
What's his name? My boy from Crash. Ryan Philippe.
Oh, yeah.
Well, he has a farting problem, you know.
That's what I heard.
WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neely, how you doing?
Okay.
Hey, Josh, you left this morning before we got a chance to spoon or fork.
Oh, boy. WQAM, hello.
George Rodriguez sucks, okay?
Okay, whatever you say. WQAM, hello.
George is my friend.
See that? Then there was yes. That took care of all three of them. Mm-hmm. Right there. That was good.
Let's spend time together.
5670560, #560 on the Verizon Singular Wireless line. That's what happens when you got about an 82-minute delay. You just punch in there,
right.
And they all vanish like into thin air, like they were never even there. WQAM, hello.
Hey Neil, how you doing?
Okay.
Hey, listen, like you mentioned, I know this briefly, but about the fog of war.
Yeah.
Pilot song. I mean.
Yeah.
You know, he doesn't know if he's, like, begging for forgiveness or
right.
trying to justify it.
Why doesn't he just come out and say, we screwed up and I'm responsible for a whole lot of, for thousands or millions of people dying and I should be on death
exactly.
row, and the same with, Johnson, who's already died, et cetera, you know, like that.
It's the only way that movie would have been justifiable if he would have been in the prison orange on death row.
Right,
kind of like
that's right. I'm so glad, I'm so relieved that even if it would have been like $2.99 that I'd go out and spend money to buy that piece of crap, I'm so glad that it was on the free on the cable, and I saw about a half an hour that was more than enough.
You know, I watched it hoping that he would eventually, say, this is how
I a little mea culpa there would have been nice, but didn't happen.
Not even, did you guys talk about the rumors? Yeah, I've been listening all day. Did you guys talk about the rumors of Kenny Way faking his death?
Faking his death?
Yeah, there's some story circulating that, produce a corpse, so to speak, and they have, anyway, kind of faked it.
And keep in mind, when a Japanese prime minister was here, where did Bush take him? To Graceland.
See?
You ever think about that? Maybe it's Elvis in Kenny Lay's car.
I think they're filling it up to, like, a all-you-can-eat down at Shoney's or something.
Okay, probably. See ya. Yeah, that's, and then of course we had the article on there, which was tongue in cheek about did Bush have Kenny Lay murdered, because that's what the right wingers would have done. That's what they did with Vince Foster. Remember that, how Hillary killed Vince Foster? All
that's
this crap.
Right
wing lunacy, man. Not just paranoia, but lunacy, as in. Yeah. Oh, and you see, Bush's first veto is going to be on stem cell research funding. You see that?
Uh huh.
Isn't that beautiful? The, as the Stone Age people continue being in the Stone Age. George said he preferred to be in the Stone Age. Speaking of that, I got the story about the mystic mushrooms.
Excellent.
It's coming. In fact, that shipment will also be on the way.
Does that mean something?
27 past 1 at 560 WQM. This may sound crazy, but experts now say that you can lose weight while you're sleeping. According to ABC News and Good Morning America medical correspondent Dr. David Katz, there's convincing evidence that a good night's sleep can really pay dividends in terms of weight control. Studies point to two hormones regulating appetite, which are in balance after people have had at least 8 hours of sleep. So call Dial-A-Mattress at 1-800-MATTRESS, open till midnight tonight, save a few bucks and shed a few pounds. Dial-A-Mattress offers you 12 months financing, no payments and no interest. Dial-A-Mattress ranked number one in the world in overall customer satisfaction, and they offer you an all-around deal that's totally unbeatable. And they have all the top brands that you know and love, too, like Sealy, Serta, Simmons, King Coral, Tempur-Pedic, and Stearns and Foster Hewitt. I've been using them for years, and I guarantee you, this is one of the easiest, the smartest pieces of shopping you could ever do. So do yourself and your waistline and your back a big favor. Call 1-800-MATTRESS or do your shopping on their website at mattress.com. 1-800-M-A-T-T-R-E-S. Leave off the last S because it stands for sensational savings.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560-QAM.
Who's going to give Ricky a blow?
On the 9/11 widows, and in particular a group that had been outspoken and critical of the administration. These broads are millionaires, lionized on TV. I've never seen people enjoying their husband's death so much.
Yes. And Coulter's so bitchy, she is full of hate. Makes everybody angry, gets the liberals all worked up. Worship by the Fox News gang, cause she's blonde and tall. But if she ever ended up missing, no one would care at all. You could be a widow, you could be a priest. You know that she'll attack you if you ever disagree. Wonder what she's thinking by dropping verbal bombs. She supports our soldiers by attacking grieving moms. Can you make her go away? Can we break her skinny legs? We wish each other face, but her bones get in the way. Is she a woman anyway? One thing we sure can say, and ghost is a disgrace.
Absolutely.
Because they dare to speak out?
To speak out using the fact that they're widows. How about sending in somebody we're allowed to respond to? No, no, no. We always have to respond to someone who just had a family member die. Because then if we respond, oh, you're questioning their authenticity. They were using their grief in order to make a political point.
So these broads, you know, are millionaires stalked by grief for us. I've never seen people enjoying their husband's death so much.
They're all over the news. All over the news. All over the news.
Oh, and by the way, the syndicate that publishes her crap says Ann Coulter didn't plagiarize for the column, but Raw Story says more possible plagiarism is found in her book.
Huh.
Nail that bitch to the wall, that's what I say. Keep after her. After him, whatever it is. Talking about drag queens, what is it?
It's a transgender person.
People who took an illegal drug made from mushrooms reported profound mystical experiences that led to behavior changes lasting for weeks, all part of an experiment that recalls the psychedelic 60s. Many of the 36 volunteers rated their reaction to a single dose of the drug called psilocybin as one of the most meaningful or spiritually significant experiences of their lives. Some compared it to the birth of a child or the death of a parent. See, there we go again with that spiritual crap. Well, what does that mean?
I don't know. Maybe they're calling it for, like, relative
spiritually
purposes.
Significant. In other words, stone off their ass.
Yeah.
Such comments just seemed unbelievable, said Roland Griffiths of the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine in Baltimore, Maryland, the study's lead author. But don't try this at home, he warned. Absolutely don't.
Absolutely.
Almost a third of the research participants found the drug experience frightening, even in a very controlled setting. That suggests people experimenting with the illicit drug on their own could be harmed, Griffiths said. Don't go to Amsterdam and don't go to any of those shops where they sell the magic mushrooms. They're all over the place.
Okay, I won't.
Viewed by some as a landmark, the study is one of the few rigorous looks in the past 40 years at the hallucinogen's effects. The researchers suggest that drugs someday may help drug addicts kick their habit or aid terminally ill patients struggling with anxiety and depression. Kind of like working at QAM, anxiety and depression. It may also provide a way to study what happens in the brain during intense spiritual experiences, the scientist said. I don't know what that is. And you know what people are thinking? That's because you're just not a spiritual person, Neil. I don't even know how to define that. What is a spiritual experience? I've had some heavenly experiences, but then like, you know,
yeah, maybe
recently.
Like that.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like when you feel the music.
In other words, like, oh, God, that's good?
Yeah.
No, I had one of those recently. Funded in part by the federal government's research was published online today by the journal Psychopharmacology. I'm sure you read that religiously.
I have a subscription.
Good. Psilocybin has been used for centuries in religious practices, and its ability to produce a mystical experience is no surprise. A mystical experience. But the new work demonstrates it more clearly than before. Do we have the Beatles and what would be one of the...
How about Magical Mystery Tour?
Magical Mystery Tour would be good, but that's not the one I was thinking of. There's an even better one.
Some Beatles in the Sky with Diamonds?
There you go. No, Magical Mystery Tour.
I had closed the freaking program.
Even 2 months after taking the drug, psilocybin. How silly of me. Most of the volunteers said the experience had changed them in beneficial ways, such as making them more compassionate, loving, optimistic, and patient. Family members and friends say they noticed a difference, too. Oh, there's nothing like a good mushroom. Charles Schuster, a professor of psychiatry and behavioral neuroscience at Wayne State University in Detroit and former director of the National Institute on Drug Abuse, called the work a landmark. I believe this is one of the most rigorously well-controlled studies ever done to evaluate psilocybin or similar substances for their potential to increase self-awareness and sense of spirituality, he said. He did not participate in the research. See, unless you experience it, you don't know what it is. Maybe that's why I never went to those head shops in Amsterdam.
Well.
Never got none of the magic shrooms. So maybe next time I go there, I'm going to have to stop by and get some.
Give it a shot.
I do like shrooms.
Report back.
Psilocybin, like LSD or mescaline, is one of a class of drugs called hallucinogens or psychedelics. While they've been studied by scientists in the past, research was largely shut down after widespread recreational abuse of the drugs in the 60s. Some work resumed in the 90s. We've lost 40 years of potential research experience with this whole class of compounds.
Sorry.
What? Sorry for what?
Why? Oh, it's a little hot.
No. Now, with modern-day scientific methods, I think it's time to pick up this research field. By the way, aren't we glad that we don't hear about Daryl Strawberry anymore? Thank God.
Great.
The study volunteers had an average age of 46, never had used hallucinogens, and participated to some degree in religious or spiritual activities such as prayer, meditation, discussion groups, or religious services. Sounds like hocus pocus to me, by focus. Each tried psilocybin during one visit to the lab and the stimulant meth, better known as Ritalin, on one or two other visits. Methylphenidate, how do you say that? That's how you say it, methylphenidate. Only six of the volunteers knew when they were getting psilocybin. Each visit lasted 8 hours. The volunteers lay on a couch in a living room-like setting, wearing an eye mask and listening to classical music. They were encouraged to focus their attention inward. Well, kind of sounds like a scene from Clockwork Orange.
They're wearing an eye mask. I wonder if they were listening to music on their iPod.
Maybe the music wasn't quite as loud as in Clockwork Orange, but... Psilocybin's effects lasted for up to 6 hours, Griffith said. 22 of the 36 volunteers reported having a complete mystical experience compared with 4 of those getting methylphenidate. Ritalin. That experience included such things as a sense of pure awareness and emerging with ultimate reality, a transcendence of... This sounds like Howard Beale. A transcendence of time and space, a feeling of sacredness or awe. Remember that one scene?
Oh, yeah.
He says, I'm in touch with everything. Birds, nature. Remember that?
Sure.
And then, of course, he passed out. Of course, he was always passing out. A feeling of sacredness or awe, and deeply felt... Oh, there's that snake in the drawer again.
Basil.
And deeply felt positive mood like joy, peace, and love. People say they can't possibly put it into words, Griffith said. Oh, let's get some of them shrooms now.
Lay them on.
2 months... Maybe Amazon will deliver us some tomorrow. 2 months later, 24 of the participants filled out a questionnaire. Two-thirds called the reaction to psilocybin one of the 5 top most meaningful experiences of their lifetimes. On another measure, one-third called it the most spiritually significant experience of their lives, another 40% ranking it in the top 5. Just like Diana Christensen said, next year we'll have all the top 5. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
They had the number 1 show on television. She was good. We'll get back to you, Diana. About 80% said that because of the psilocybin experience, they still had a sense of well-being or life satisfaction that was either raised moderately or very much. And some probably very, very, very much, as in...
I have no life.
Right. I think that was probably one of the criteria for being selected for the test.
I have no life.
Yeah. In fact, let's get some of these calls. Let's get Prozac Ron off that Prozac and get him under some shrooms. What do you say?
I wonder if that'll make him...
Hi!
I know what we can do with him. Just send him over some toadstools would be good.
Or just some stools.
Oh, no. I think he's got plenty of those. And usually sends them our way. 19 till 2 at 560 WQA. I mean, let's watch that again.
Okay.
I haven't seen that in a long time. Not that song that Jimi Hendrix did, Purple Arm.
Damn, Jim.
That was one nasty
looking. Don't shoot
in
that.
Oh, and then the doctor in the, I keep forgetting, the doctor in that movie when they stopped, was it in Carolinas or somewhere they stopped because he had that bad
right.
Purple arm. That was the guy that played the pedophile in Happiness.
That is correct.
Wow. He seemed to be nauseated by the sight of that thing.
Well, who
19 till 2, if I end his arm, too. How is Jared Leto doing? Don't see too much of him no more.
Yes, I do. His band just released another album.
His band, I know that.
Yeah, and he's got a video that's on a lot, and he's keeping busy. He's touring, I think.
Well, he's no Emil Hirsch, I'll tell you that. Well, I'm pleased that Josh liked that movie. I had some crapitation about that, whether you'd like it or not, because, yeah, it was a little...
And by the way, Josh isn't gay. His roommate might be, but he's not.
Well, figures. Makes sense.
It's the ecstasy.
That's it. I'll leave that. I'll let that speak for itself. 18 till 2. We got Kimba Bocamper at 2. Mad Dog at 4. We got Talking Hardball with a Crow. Boy, we got a big pair of what that we put that on for 3 hours. Holy moly. And Eddie K at 10 o'clock. Hey, hurricane season is here. Make no mistake about that. Don't wait until it's too late to protect your home. Hurricane Shutter Outlet has your do-it-yourself hurricane panels. This is the smart way to go. Why bother with those big home improvement warehouses when Hurricane Shutter Outlet is your complete source for hurricane protection? They've got all the things you need to get the job done and save you a ton of cash, too. They stock all sizes of clear polycarbonate hurricane panels and aluminum panels that are cut to your needs and ready for you to pick up or deliver. All products are Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach County approved, too. Contractors and installers are welcome and they accept all major credit cards. Dade, Broward, and Palm Beach County approved. Step-by-step instructions included. So why would you want to pay all that extra money for installation when the Hurricane Shutter Outlet can get you all the things you need to do it yourself and save all that cash? You'll find them at 600 Anson Boulevard in Hallandale on the east side of 95 between Hallandale Beach Boulevard and Pembroke Road. Call them at 954-237-7083 or log on to HurricaneShutterOutlet.com. Tell them that Neil sent you by and get $100 off on a minimum order of 350 square feet. That's 954-237-7083 or on the wicked web, HurricaneShutterOutlet.com.
This is Neil Rogers. This is 560 QAM.
It's been brought to my attention that your ratings are dying now. Well, I don't want to show you what a big asset I was to you and how. You thought you could find somebody good enough to fill my baggy pants? It ain't easy. There ain't no chance I'll ever be coming back. Outside of considering a lucrative contract. If you want to know what'll save you from shutting that transmitter down... That's easy. Sure.
All you need is mouth. All you need is mouth. All you need is a show.
Oh,
you must have had to find a way something.
Yeah.
Jack told me to give you this.
What?
You see? What are you going to do, fire me, huh?
Like old times.
Okay, 147 at QM. By the way, speaking of Ricky Williams, is he kicking it lame style or what in the CFL?
I haven't heard.
Oh, well, wait till you hear this. The Toronto Argonauts are sticking the joint out, and their game this past weekend, he got 9 yards and 6 carries.
He's making strides, I'm sure.
He is kicking it lame style, like I said. Weak. Weak, Ricky. Molly Ivins writes, the politics of greed. She says, I don't get it. What's the percentage in keeping the minimum wage at $5.15 an hour after 9 years? This is such an unnecessary and nasty Republican move. Congress has voted 7 times to raise its own wages since the last minimum wage budged. Of course, Congress always raises its own salary in the dark of night, hoping nobody will notice. But now it does the same with the minimum wage, quietly killing it. Anyone who doesn't think this is a country where the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer needs to check the numbers. This is Bush country, where a rising tide lifts all yachts. According to the current issue of Mother Jones, 1 in 4 U.S. jobs pays less than a poverty-level income. Since 2000, the number of Americans living below the poverty line at any one time has risen steadily. Now 13%. 37 million Americans are officially poor, and they didn't even count Josh. Bush's tax cuts extended until 2010 saved those earning between 20 and 30 grand, an average of $10 a year, while those making a million are saved $42,700. Let me read that sentence again. Bush's tax cuts extended until 2010 saved those earning between 20 and 30 grand, an average of $10 a year, while those making $1 million are saved $42,700. In 2002, Senator Charles Grassley, Republican of Iowa, compared those who point out such statistics as the one above to Adolf Hitler. Surely he meant Stalin. Bush has diverted $750 million to healthy marriages by shifting funds from social services, mostly child care. Bush has proposed cutting housing programs for low-income people with disabilities by 50%. A series of related stats, starting with the news that 2 out of 3 new jobs are in the suburbs, shows how the poor are further disadvantaged in the job hunt by lack of public or private transportation. Meanwhile, for those who have been following the collapse of the pension system, please note a series in the Wall Street Journal by Ellen Schultz taking a hard look at executive pension obligations. Benefits for executives now account for a significant share of pension obligations in the U.S., an average of 8% of large companies. Sometimes a company's obligation for a single executive's pension approaches $100 million. These liabilities are largely hidden because corporations don't distinguish them for overall pension obligations in their federal financial findings. As a result, savings that companies make by curtailing pensions of regular retirees, which have totaled billions of dollars in recent years, can mask a rising cost of benefits for executives. Executive pensions, even when they won't be paid until years from now, drag down the earnings today. And they do so in a way that's disproportionate to their size because they're not funded with dedicated assets. It seems to me that we've seen enough evidence over the years that the capitalist system is not going to be destroyed by an outside challenger like communism. It'll be destroyed by its own internal greed. Greed is the greatest danger as we develop an increasingly winner-take-all system. And voices like the Wall Street Journal's editorial page encourage this mentality by insisting that any form of regulation is bad, but for whom? It is so discouraging to watch this country become less and less fair. Justice for all seems like an embarrassingly archaic tag. Republicans have rigged the lottery of life in this country in ways we don't even know about yet. The new bankruptcy law is unfair. The new college loan rules are worse. The system's been stacked so that large corporations have an inside track over small businesses and getting government contracts. We won't see the full consequences of this mean and careless legislation for years, but it's starting to affect us already.
Uh-huh.
Well, you know, you guys are making a big bucks. Why should you?
That's right, yeah.
How many votes we got? Oh, look at that, 1,060. If we'd have really given it the big push, we could have made 1,100, but we don't want to do that. We don't want to set the bar too high, especially during the summertime. 1,060, I'll take it. Other than our president, than your president, excuse me, the politician you hate the most is Dick Cheney, 470 votes. They hate Dick. Catherine Harris won away. And, of course, remember the president who left in disgrace, Dick Nixon. See what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Catherine Harris won away. Jeb Bush, your fat-ass governor, 97. Phony as a $42 bill. Hillary, 80. Tom DeLay, 69. Oh, I'm sure he won't be pleased to hear that. Rick Santorum, 47. Jew Lieberman, 45. Ted Kennedy, 38. I hate this poll, 31. Newt Gingrich, 19. Bush, 1, 19. John McCain, 12. Rudy Giuliani, 9. Al Gore, 8. Bill Clinton, 5. And John Kerry, 5. Well, at least John Kerry, at least he got a little recognition there, you know? He moved up with Al Gore.
About time.
And they do have something in common. They both were elected president. 152 at 560 WQM.
Bye, bye, bye!